Our obsession with Iceland continues. That's the band Kallio. Yes, they're from Iceland. And a song called No Good. I forgot about that one. I'm like, that song I love. It's on the Spectrum a lot. A channel I definitely...
Oh, no, an autistic song?
I love the Spectrum. It's one of the few channels I actually listen to on Sirius XM. And they play Kallio. And then someone reminded me, hey, man, that band Kallio, they're from Iceland as well. So there you go. No Good. That's how we start today.
I said yesterday that there would not be a Jeopardy category because there wasn't five good Icelandic rock bands. And,
yeah.
And as usual on this show, as soon as I open my mouth, I've been proven wrong.
I don't think you've been proven wrong.
Yeah, I don't know if there's been five.
That kind of, well, there was no yesterday. Travis.
No,
Travis
get out of here. It's got to be bands where most people go, that's that band.
One, that's one right there. We're one. But yesterday, I thought we left here yesterday with at least two more.
They're relatively new. Most people wouldn't know the name of that band. I mean, next time I hear that song, I'll go, who does that again?
No, I'm going to go Iceland.
I'll remember they're from Iceland.
The next time I hear that, that's all I'm going to say is, oh, Iceland. Is that the only thing going through my brain?
I didn't know who that was until you just said Iceland. You guys were talking about Jack White before. I really thought that was Jack White.
It sounds Jack White-ish.
A little bit. Has a little bit
it's
of that in there.
A little white-stripish, absolutely.
A bit bluesy. So, how's everybody doing, Jimmy?
I'm going blind. I can't see, man. I bought those fucking readers that Vic told me about, the $2 ones or $20 ones.
Right.
They magnifying glasses on your face. And they help a little bit, but they give you a headache, and then you look at the TV.
Yeah.
I have to give in, dude. I'm 47. I'm almost 48. I got to buy fucking reading glasses. I have to do it.
No, you got the LASIK like I did. Doesn't you should be good for a little while longer.
Now,
I'm still good.
I was good for... My eyes might have been worse than yours. I was good for all these years. From, like, what, 7 years? I got 8 years?
Yeah.
And now it's just time for the reading glasses.
I wonder if they updated that procedure.
Maybe. I don't know.
I wonder.
I don't know if I want to go through that again anyway.
Because, really?
Dude,
oh, my God. That was the greatest
you
thing
both
I've ever...
did it?
Yes,
did it.
It was the greatest
as
thing I ever did.
No, but I mean, I have a problem. I have a problem. I have an injury in one of my eyes, my cornea.
Yeah.
Like from a fucking a baseball hit in my face.
Jesus.
So they almost couldn't do it on mine, so I don't know if I could go through it again.
Okay. Well, what were you saying, E-Rock?
No, I didn't know that. I was telling Jim that, like, it was such an easy procedure that why wouldn't you want to get it done again?
Well, I see halos at night. Like, I really do. Not just on you because
halo.
You're a good boy.
But because
around the lights, I had that effect and my
halo.
Eyes are dry.
Oh, you're going, okay.
I'm going.
Beyonce and Lionel Richie.
No, I was going with the big one, the big broad. I forgot her name. Adele.
Rolando.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
Hello. From the other side.
Hello.
Well, it's a good song.
We had Dr. Filatov back in the day at Diamond Vision. And he was going to do, he ended up doing a whole bunch of advertising on the old show, the Opie and Anthony show, starring Jim Norton. And and I was one of the first to go in. I was the guinea pig. The guy was only doing them in Canada and Mexico. He was starting to do it in the States, but in general, this was his big push to really go forward with his business because they wouldn't allow you to do it in the States. So he would fly people to Canada and Mexico to get this LASIK surgery. So I went and got it done, and then I'm in the waiting room, and I'm like, man, my left eye is really blurry still. He's like, it's fine. Let me take a look. The panic on his face. It turns out there was a fold. And if I went home with that fold, I would have been fucked. And then he had to rush me back in to, you know, take the fold out. And then went home, woke up from a little Xanax action, which they give you, and saw 2015 was
all good.
Was officially what my eyes were.
Wow.
And
does it help with reading stuff though? Like,
it was amazing for everything.
No, but I mean, after a certain point, can't you not do it? Like, your eyes just get older.
Well, that's
maybe. Yeah. Okay.
No, that's what
maybe young heart.
That's what I was getting at, because then I had to learn all about this for the live reads and stuff, blah, blah, blah. And he said, when you get older, middle age, they don't have a procedure for that yet when the muscles just start kind of getting, tired or weaker or whatever the heck right. You want to say. So that's why I started this by saying, I wonder if they have new procedures that now take care of the fact that you're in middle age and that your muscles are actually just weaker.
You know what? Maybe they do in the last 8 years. E-Rock has a photo. What photo is of me?
Of Opie.
Oh, okay.
Smashing them with a hammer.
I think nowadays.
You had these big, thick glasses.
They were, all right, whatever. I'll let you.
The frame, not the lens. I'm not beating you up.
I never had
what it was.
I had never had the thick glasses.
No, but the frames were, they're not like those thin metal ones that
Where's
everyone
the picture?
Wears. Oh, okay. I got to go grab them in the back. Oh, okay.
You know, every once in a while, I'll do this with my index finger. I'll
Out
just,
of habit.
I'll put his finger in his ass right now.
I'm the German
coach.
I'm the German soccer coach. Just get a nice whiff.
We have to suffer through this every day, America. Please listen.
Because he'll put one finger in his ass and the other finger, he makes the shh sound so he can't say anything.
So we can't do anything.
Exactly.
Jimmy and I are trying to have a drink of our morning beverage, and then he's got both hands busy over here.
Yeah, now we have unexplained hard-ons. Oh,
well, mine's explained. Mine's completely explained.
I just go with a nice little sniff to get my day going. But, yeah, I'll do that with my index finger in between my eyes. Like, I still have glasses
pushing
on.
Pushing them up.
That's so fucking weird that still happens from time to time.
I think the computers and the cell phones make it hard. Like, your eyes are being strained in a way. Like, I don't read on laptops. Like, I mean, like, I don't read a book on an iPad.
Right.
Only on, like, the Kindle or something.
Yeah.
Or paper. So I think that's helped a little bit. But the phone, man, the constant reading, the constant scrolling, and everything's on it. It's just fucking my eyes up.
All you have to do is take a little break from your phone, and your eyes come all the way back.
It helps it?
Yes. You just strained them a little bit.
Everything comes all the way back. I'm focusing. I'll binge watch The Wire, and my neck is locked up.
Yeah.
And I'm just sitting there because I realize I'm 9 hours into something.
Wait, you do it on your iPad? Tense because they live in the neighborhood.
That is true.
You watch your shit on an iPad where you have
depends.
To hold it?
It just depends. You know, it's the different app. I'm not tech savvy, so in my apartment, depending on what's going on at night, if I'll go to bed, I'll grab the iPad and watch something because
right.
I don't have a TV in my bedroom. I did, and I stupidly took it out.
I do have to say, I did get a little pair of glasses for driving at night.
Ooh, Gloria!
But I went to the eye doctor, and she's like, "You're on the border. You don't really officially need glasses, but let me show you how much better you'll see if you choose to get them."
And then you,
as soon as I saw that, I'm like, "Oh, Jesus! All right." Give me the fucking glasses. So they're just in my car.
No, exactly.
I can't use them to read because it's for far side.
Being nearsighted, you see far away.
To see whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
Could you ask Kenny to get some? He refuses to get glasses at night.
Oh, my God.
Kenny, he's a ninja. He's a, he won't,
but it scares
he won't
me.
Get, he didn't want to reveal to everybody he's really a ninja.
I don't
want to
bother people.
Yeah, exactly. That's the way
well, you're bothering us because you're...
You're about to drive me into an embankment.
Right. Yeah,
yes. I don't want to be a bother.
Kenny said, what does that sign say? It's a milk truck. But he won't wear them because he likes, you know, I get it because, like, with struggling with these, you feel older when you got to get glasses. You don't want to get them. It's like a weird admission, like, okay, yeah. I am now here. And it's
yeah, that was me, right?
But if how many 20-year-olds have glasses?
True.
You're Travis, tons. Young, yeah. In shape, handsome.
I have glasses in fifth grade.
No, I'm not done, though.
Yeah.
Please, continue.
Travis, why didn't you ever get the LASIK?
For the reasons that you guys are talking about, because... Because
you're gay?
Yes. They wouldn't allow me in.
That's what we're getting at.
Yeah.
You're going to wake up with the dick picture with the dick on his lip.
Because I didn't know what the long-term, you know, effects were, because it was so new. Like, how do you know what if you're going to need it again in 10 years or 15 years?
I got it in, I think, around 2000, and I'm still good in general. Like I said, the night driving a little bit, but that's about it so far. It's been amazing to be able to just throw all that shit away.
Eh?
And then Dr. Filatov dies on us. Fuck.
Dr. Phil's dead?
Dr. Filatov.
Oh, sorry.
Filatov. He was an amazing man.
Did you hear the hopefulness in my voice?
He literally did, I would say, almost 1,000 of our listeners.
Wow.
I would bet the number's close to 1,000. In my family alone, I got 5 or 6 people done. I got a lot of the Brewers done, Jim Brewer's family, and then listeners galore. It was crazy.
Me?
How many people.
Jimmy, I got that.
Of course.
Was it Filatov by
that
point?
I'm
no?
sorry.
Yeah, we but, no, was it Filatov or I might have switched to someone else by that point?
What year did you have it done?
I want to say 2007. This was like
K-Rock. He was done.
Yeah, who was in K-Rock?
I mean, his life was done by 2007.
Oh,
he died when we were off the air.
My girl had hers about when you had yours, and she said the same thing. Although she believes hers might be fading a little bit. She's about 15, 16 years in.
Oh, you still dating her?
Yes.
Oh, it would be a funnier story if my girl had hers done, and then 2 weeks later she left me.
Right. That's the punchline.
She could really.
That's the punchline. Once she came into focus, my ass was out.
Holy
said,
fuck,
who are you?
Who the fuck am I going out with? Goddamn, get your ass out of here.
Oh, wow. That's from NEW. Wow.
Ew, I look like a fucking dork.
No, you got your sunglasses on, your little blonde hair.
barrel.
Could you have used a smaller hammer? What the fuck is that?
It's the one that you take the handle off and it screws in. It turns into a screwdriver. It's like nine other tools.
That is
actually not. It's an old school hammer for people with little tiny hands.
It's what Andy Dufresne used in Shawshank.
Thank you. It's a rock hammer. It's a rock hammer.
I broke so much stuff back then. They gave me my own hammer with a name on it.
It says Opie's hammer.
Oh my god! Andy Dufresne. I'm with you. Fucking dork.
Let me see all these.
The hair color is questionable.
What do you mean?
I don't know.
It's very strawberry blondish.
Is that what I'm saying? There's a lot going on there.
Yeah, it's
you had a stylist, is all I'm saying.
Oh, God, no!
You didn't have a stylist?
That's sure he did. It's called Ann Murray.
God, no!
Dude, I was thinking something Canadian, and you nailed it. I was thinking Canadian lesbian, and you fucking nailed it.
Yeah, so Michael J. Fox, Ann Murray
yes,
thing.
Sort
of my God. God, no. I hated my mousy... It was mousy red back then. It was more red... No, God, no. I'll tell you the truth. I came home with highlights once. One time, and the look on my dad's face, I'm like, okay, I'm never doing this.
Oh, you did it
again.
Early. You went early.
It was, I'm trying to remember what year, but...
he didn't even have to say one word. Wow. He just, the look. The look, all he did, like,
yeah, I'm not doing this ever again. Yes.
You're really my son.
And I swear that is the truth. I tried it once, saw the look on his face, and
that was it.
Nah, I'm done.
A couple of my buddies went with the perm. The same thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah, around that same era, they went.
Yeah.
And the same reason. But it was their moms, though. They're like, my mom looked at me, she's like, my hairdresser does this better than whoever did this to you.
I hate to say, I was out of college at this time, too. I was probably a little too old to be attempting that shit.
I can tell there's some fear in the photo from young man trying to make his mark.
Oh my God, Andrew Dice Clay.
There's Kenny.
This is Jim Norton's first appearance on the show in studio.
I don't think I'm in any pictures. I don't know.
That's Fran, and there's Dice.
Dice is in your chair. Anthony's across.
Cigarette in his hand.
That's right.
Wow.
Old school Dice, man.
Are you still posting
these? Todd Rodskin? Wow.
Are you still posting these old photos there, Eric?
We got to continue. I think we stopped at 2000.
You got to continue.
Frantic Fran, her name was.
Frantic Fran was in her 80s, so she's
long
gone.
Oh, there I am.
Gone.
Wow.
There's Jim Norton right there in the background.
Can I have a copy of that? I wanted that. Was my first time on the show.
Dude.
Man, that's crazy
Kenny.
Good.
There's me and Kenny.
There's Kenny, too. Oh, my God. That's
You look like somebody brought their son to work.
They did.
That's how you look now.
Kenny still
you're back
looks,
down to that weight.
You're actually
probably a little heavier in that picture.
I think he's thinner. I think he's thinner.
You're probably thinner.
In that photograph, right?
I'm so glad there's a picture there, man.
There I am.
Who was the old
man? That's me in the background.
Her husband?
When I used to have a mustache.
Wow. Look at Anthony's pit stains. Fucking Anthony has pit stains. Wow.
This was Jimmy's first appearance on the show.
I'm so happy there's a
photo
from
good,
that
man.
Day, man.
That's really awesome.
Yeah, that's... what year was that? 2000.
That was... when was that year?
It was October 19th.
October 19th, 2000.
That's probably about right. That's probably about right.
And can we go to the Beacon photos? I don't know why we do. I'm just looking for them. I happen to see those.
Now we're walking down memory lane.
I'm not in any of these, I don't think. I wish I was.
Oh, that's good. There you go.
That was the week of the Subway series. Oh, those are the lesbians on the couch. They were pretty.
Yeah,
Look at
you. You look like you have a LeBron ass on that one.
What is that?
You don't. You got the NBA
like
chunky
a,
butt. Yeah, you really,
like
but you don't. You don't.
Show.
You know.
Yeah.
Those sort of.
They're doing the Sharks and the Jets, and they're trying to coordinate.
Right. He's Chuck D, and he's Flavor Flav. That's what's going on right there.
What? Your pants are so baggy.
Why? Those pants are giant.
Yo, that's man, why your pants so baggy, man?
I don't remember ever having
was this close
giant
pants. With Dice?
It might have been.
I like it. Look at Ant throwing it. He's Eminem, and you're over here. This is Beastie Boys shit.
What the fuck is this?
Look at that. Is Beastie Boy? You got a beard. Look at the beard. That's
Wow, those pants are giant.
Oh man,
the lesbians. That's right.
Well, the Mets were in the World Series, and then you got the Yankees fans. I'm like, can't the Mets fans get along with the Yankee fans?
So you had two lesbians.
And they're like, boo, never, no. And I'm like, really?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden they come out,
the
two
wrestle.
Girls, one wearing the Mets jersey, the other wearing the Yankees jersey, and then they just went at it on the lesbian couch for the older listeners.
One photo of me from MSG, but there's not. I was really bad. You talk about doing pictures now. I did none back then. I have no recording of that.
I've never. Yeah, me neither. I have zero of. I'm happy about that, actually.
Dice has a.
You like archives, and yeah.
I do. I like to archive.
No. I know you do.
I bring friends over. We just watch me. I have a me party every 2 weeks. I have what we call a me party. Everybody comes over and watches me.
I've met people like you in Los Angeles.
Oh my.
Several times.
What is E-Rock circling in this picture? I can explain everything. Okay. I can explain everything.
So
what?
At the beginning,
you're wearing Bull Meacham's jacket from the Great Santini.
Or like Marty's jacket in Back to the Future 2.
I'm with Norton on Bull Meacham.
Wow. Wow. Wow.
Hey, sports fans, get a couple of lesbians.
Exactly. Wow.
Everything you wore in these couple days are way bigger than
they were.
You.
Very big.
I don't know
yeah.
why everything's so big.
That was the style. Also, I'll run to your defense.
All right.
For a second.
And then know. That medallion thing was something Dice gave all
I
of us.
I know. I had mine. I gotta find mine. I don't know where mine is. The 2000 Madison Square Garden.
Yeah.
See, look at that. If he's you got to wear. Look what he's wearing. That was the style.
Dice took some great pictures when we did. He did, and Jimmy did mostly, and they were kind enough to give me and Anthony a little time on the Madison Square Garden stage. But after the show, I remember taking pictures with Dice in an empty Madison Square Garden. I would love those pictures.
Certainly.
He's got them.
Over the years,
I've asked Dice, but that's almost impossible because he's got thousands and thousands of pictures. He was always taking pictures all over the place.
Game 5 of the Subway Series, Mets and Yankees, is when that night was. It was 6 days after a sold-out Beacon.
Yeah.
Good God. Oh, man.
And sold he still did numbers at the Garden. Did numbers. Well, didn't sell it out, but it was pretty damn impressive.
If you had combined that with the Beacon and there was no Subway Series Game 5, he would have done...
Well, what happened? The Beacon wouldn't let him cancel.
He wanted to roll the Beacon into the Garden.
And they said no.
But he couldn't, even though it's the same people.
And he had so much heat, he said, fuck it, I'm still going to do the Garden. 5 days after doing the two shows at the Beacon.
That's well.
Was it two or one?
That's nice.
I feel like it was two. Maybe it was one.
I thought you would know
better about that. So... Man. Going down memory lane.
Look at you again. Yeah, no, that's cool. I don't know any of this because I was
wearing
working.
Daddy's jacket.
Yes.
Is that Ish? Who shit on you right there? I'm just taking notes on who shit on who.
I still have that jacket, E-Rock. I'll bring it in. It'll fit you perfectly.
Oh. No, it wouldn't. He did. He actually shit on himself right there.
Yeah, all right.
I happened to see that when you were going through. These old the NEW photos looking for the glasses, and I just happened to see that Dice thing. I'm like, I gotta.
Yeah, I mean,
if you can give me that, E-Rock, I would love that, please.
E-Rock was posting a lot of these on a Twitter account. What was it called? I forget. OA Photos or something
OA
like
photos,
that.
OA Photos, yeah.
So you got to start updating that again.
Those archives still are there, but I'll start putting the old stuff.
Warren Zevon. Oh, these are all before me. Okay, I'm like, oh, no, that doesn't sound familiar.
Warren Zevon. You got Warren Zevon?
No.
It says Warren Zevon right there.
I don't remember.
Folder's empty.
Not their show.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't.
Somebody else. Right. Oh, that was the old morning show.
Never mind. That's E-Rockets.
Wow, there's Warren Zevon, though.
And somebody.
Who's that? I know that guy. Who's that guy next to me?
He's the bass player for the Atlanta Rhythm Section.
Is he?
No.
Oh, why would I say is he?
That guy.
Who's she?
They're both dead.
Oh, wow.
Mason?
Huh?
Wasn't it Mason Kalinske?
That's not Mason or Kalinske. That's no, that's...
Is that Sue Kalinske? No. She's blonde.
No, it's not Sue Kalinske.
That's
Hell
the
no.
dude that did... oh, God. And then he did over there for a while, college radio. Oh, my God.
He looks
I forgot his name.
You know who he looks like? He looks like Keanu Reeves' client in the fucking Devil's Advocate, rubbing the underside of the desk while he's staring at the girl.
Looks like Paul on Cheers.
No, I'm telling you. If you look up the bass player, Paul, I'll can give you the name. Look up Paul Golub. He's the bass player for the Atlanta Rhythm Section, I believe. It's one of the strangest looking people in rock and roll. Oh, and that guy looks like him.
He was pretty legendary in the music, radio world.
That guy.
Then he picked all his own songs. And I know the guy's name. I'm having a fucking brain fart.
Oh, Joe Chur. Chur with an umlaut over the U. Who's that? She's cute.
He was married to Flunda, your Icelandic wife.
Holy shit.
That's cool. That's a cool Warren Zevon picture.
What do they have in that building now? I mean, the Brooklyn Diner is there. That's where it is. And I forget we broadcast. I'll walk by there and go like, oh, yeah, I used to fucking win this building.
10th floor, right? Mm. Yeah, I don't know what's in there. Just offices, I guess.
Yeah.
All right, where were we? Glasses, LASIK.
Yes, and it worked for y'all, and everything's good, but Jimmy is still going blind.
Yes, I am.
Callio, no good.
I need some new glasses.
Yeah, that's what we're... Maybe you just picked the wrong readers.
You know, these were ones I grabbed in CVS. Like, I need to go...
But did you try a whole bunch of them?
Yeah, but they're basically magnifying glasses. They're not going to have any of the subtlety that or anything that the regular, a really good pair of glasses will do for me.
Right.
So maybe I should try the LASIK again. I don't know if you can do something if I'm just getting older that can fix that.
Mm.
It might not be a...
Dr. Steve could probably answer. Maybe.
Yeah, the eye muscles get very tired. Basically, they have push-ups for the eyes. It's a new thing.
Anyway... I was just reading about the fridge.
William the Refrigerator Perry.
Yeah. Oh, my God. This just hit today.
Yeah.
I knew he was down on his luck, but wow.
Yeah, but he does a good job booking the show. I mean.
William.
Oh, my God. You with the glasses. That picture of you. Look at you.
That is so strange to see. I haven't had glasses in 16 years, but I had them since I was 8 years old. Huh. That's really weird to see. Anyway.
Got a good head of hair, though. That's a good head of hair. Still hanging in.
It's all right. I'm doing okay all these years later. All right.
You look very focused.
What do you mean?
I don't. Yeah, I'm just look right there. It looks like you care about what you're doing, and I look across the table.
yes, Vic. I used to care a lot.
I used to care a lot. I'm sorry.
Oh boy, did I used to care. Now I don't give a shit.
That's why I'm in here.
Oh boy, did I care. Yes, you're right.
I'm here to help you not care.
You certainly noticed that one. William the Refrigerator Perry, down on his luck. He's only 53 years old. He's living in a retirement home in his hometown in, where is he?
South Carolina.
And, wow, man, he can barely walk. He can barely feel his legs below his knees.
Hands either, I think, right?
On his hands. He's an alcoholic, which he admitted in 2011, but he still drinks vodka by the bottle. In his playing days, he was in the low to mid 300 range. He now weighs 450 pounds. He's got a Hummer.
Lucky him.
Really?
He hangs out in a Hummer that he pees in.
Ugh.
He pees in. Supposedly the Hummer smells really fucking bad. He can't control his bladder, so sometimes he just pees in his Hummer. This is William the Refrigerator Perry. He has no fucking money.
Somebody made some bad financial decisions. So many of these guys make bad financial decisions, man.
Yeah, he had to sell his ring.
Yeah, I was getting
that. That's one of them.
That was my punchline.
Oh, well, I thought the punchline was him peeing in his Hummer while he sits and drinks vodka all day.
Here's my ring. It's usually the setup where I tinkle on myself.
I thought the Super Bowl would be a more impressive story. Yeah, he sold his ring. Size 25 for $200,000 to pay some fucking debts. That is sad.
When was that? I wonder when he did that.
I don't know. They don't have the year on that
one. If he's on the long road down, that might have been even a few years ago.
He made millions.
Sure he did.
He had a lot of endorsements. He lost it all.
He was on every Bob Hope special with Brooke Shields and Little Emmanuel Lewis. That was Bob Hope's go.
Right.
William the Refrigerator Perry, Brooke Shields, Little Emmanuel Lewis. That was his triumvirate for like 2 or 3 years.
And good old Mike Ditka. He just says, it's a great life wasted. He ain't fucking around with William the Refrigerator Perry. He goes, there's no reason it has to happen. A bad deal. No, because I think Perry said something like, I was dealt a bad deal here. And but
how in the fuck was he dealt a bad deal?
Maybe he had a bad financial. Yeah.
I don't know. But that's all. There's no reason it has to happen. A bad deal. No, he got a great deal. In life, you got to help yourself. It's tragic. I think he's giving up. And the question in my mind is why? He's only 53.
Spoken like a coach. That
sounded totally Ditka-like. When you were reading that, I could immediately envision Ditka.
Well, fucking naming this guy.
No, I agree. I'm with you. You know, totally.
I mean, he is beloved.
I'll get pissed off because Walter Payton didn't get a touchdown in that fucking Super Bowl, and this fat ass did.
Right.
I'll get really mad about that in a second.
Look, he's beloved. We all know that. And that was an amazing team. Sure. And he did
You chose to suck the crack pipe dick.
Was he doing drugs?
I'm no alcohol. alcohol, the worst, you know, I mean, the easiest drug to
right.
get.
But there's no way he has to be like this. He's living in a retirement home at 53 years old.
Wow. Yeah, he did give up.
Totally. Yeah.
That's really, really, really sad.
It's got to be hard, though, when you lose that much money. When you lose millions to get yourself back and go, knowing that you can never make those again. It's not like he's an author.
Sure.
When you come back and go, okay, I've lost everything. What do I do?
Yeah, your income stream is over.
And there's no way to get it back unless you maybe write a book about your life. I don't even know if that would do it.
But how did he lose his money? That's the question.
He bought a town in North Georgia. Somebody talked him into.
If you want to see a great 30 for 30 that certainly broke. I mean, it sounds like that's the story here with the refrigerator. Turns out most of these athletes, a few years after they retire, they're broke. Because they just assume that their playing careers are going to go on forever, and they're going to make all this money, so they spend like they're going to make this money for a real long time, and then it just doesn't match up.
They act temporarily rich, and it's just not realistic.
I got it. I was late.
I like that.
I'm way late. As usual.
It's funny because Lenny Dykstra talks about this in his book that I'm going through. We're talking to Lenny tomorrow. Wow, Lenny Dykstra is he's leaving it all out on the field.
It's a tapestry.
But he talks about how, you know, when the baseball was on strike, he was one of the guys going, I don't want to, you know, cross the picket line or anything, but we got to figure this shit out. Because he figured out that he himself was losing $34,000 a day. Mm-hmm. And he was talking to his fellow players going, we're not going to make this money forever. We got to make the money now.
Yeah.
And I think he said that the average career for a baseball player back then was a little over 5 years, the average.
Yeah. NFL's like, it used to be 2.7, and now it's like 3.8. It's still under four.
Under 4 years.
I think so, yeah. But I remember it was under three forever. I wrote a term paper on this when I was in college. That's how sad, you know, but I still don't think
so it's... So most of these guys make millions for 4 years, and then the rest of their lives, that's it. They're not going to come close to making that unless they're one of the lucky ones that gets, you know,
Peyton Manning, 19 years, 20
well, yeah,
years.
Sure.
But no, you got to be an aberration. You got to be an anomaly.
Most of those guys are lucky if they open up a car wash or something.
If you get 10.
That's a killer, too. They said car washes, man. Fucking so many guys go into that. It seems like an easy way to make money.
Yeah, and it's a...
Yeah, it's hard to make back $8 million, $6 at a time. You want a treat with that?
No.
An extra buck.
Bars and restaurants. Yep. You don't want the Jimmy Norton Sports Bar? You don't want Chip Chipperson Sports Bar?
Fuck yeah, they would.
The three most volatile things they all go into are car washes and restaurants and bars.
You got to be a big name to make money, like Elway, Aikman, like those the giant quarterbacks that have those car dealerships. That's
I was going to go Ford.
The fucking steak places. Don Shula has a good steak
that's
place.
That's still risky, though.
They're very risky.
The food is crazy.
Very. Right. DiMaggio's steak place, he passed away, but his steak place in San Francisco, of all places, was amazing. I ate 3 years ago.
The Shula's, he's done it, but good God. You know, it's still so. The boring road is just buy some, you know, Connecticut stock. And
the Karen Carpenter have one seed and leave place for some real bust.
she was vegan before everybody was vegan.
The ESPN restaurants couldn't do well. How would a place based on one player? Right. Well, the ESPN restaurants, was the food lousy? Sometimes the food is shit, but in a restaurant where it's named like for Shula or John Elway, those are legitimate steak places just to have their name on.
But it's in Chicago.
Is it good?
Yeah, it's absolutely delicious.
But it's also not fair. The ESPN restaurant was in the middle of Times Square. The rent on that was ridiculous.
They had it in hotels and things around the country.
Sports steak? What could go wrong?
That's the mindset. No,
it does matter as far as you know, who's cooking and preparing and the deals they have with the food. Like you said, John Elway's steak place. It's really an upper tier kind of thing.
So are Shula's, yeah.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
But all these chains and just having one sports bar based on an athlete is not enough to draw people in after the first week.
Right, after the first week, or just fans of that. How do you get people passing through town, you know, to go to, you know, like Bubby Brister's place?
Nice pull.
You know,
nice
funny.
Pull,
that's a good pull.
I was thinking of Bubby Brister and Nick Lowry recently because they came to Governor's when I was there with someone else. I don't remember who else.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
But I remember we were hanging. Yeah.
Keep going.
I forgot.
That's pretty cool. Yeah.
No shit.
That's
right.
A great pull.
I thought Ben Roethlisberger had a weird shaped head until you just said Bubby Brister, and I think he had a stranger shaped head.
Yeah, Ben
Louisiana head. Both of them are some sort of misshapen Louisiana head.
Yeah, Ben Roethlisberger more had just great pickup finesse.
Right? Can you go down here where the light bulb's out? That's his
Is that
line.
What he did?
Yeah, meet me in the hallway right there by the ladies' room. Ooh. Now that was in North Georgia. I know that. If you're going where I think you're going, I remember that story.
Anyway, so fucking Lenny Dykstra, the book is pretty damn good. He's coming in here tomorrow.
It's called House of Nails.
House of Nails.
Somebody was calling me and asking me about it yesterday. That's
House of Nails. I mean, he has a lot to say about Davey Johnson. He didn't like Davey Johnson.
Who played second base for the Atlanta Braves and was one of the best hitting second basemen of all time.
Okay, I'll guess. Davey Johnson. I solved the riddle.
Lenny Dykstra said that Davey Johnson drank a lot.
All right.
And then Davey Johnson in the paper today is saying Lenny Dykstra has his problems, so he shouldn't be pointing fingers at me. And basically was saying, yeah, maybe I would have a couple drinks on the plane after a game, but I was never drinking during the game.
The whole 86 team was a mess.
Yeah, I got to say, that's just a titty bar on the air and on the ground and wherever
I remember
they were
going to games with my dad, and they would run out of the dugout there because Roger McDowell was lighting fireworks and throwing him at people's feet.
Yeah, he was the prankster.
Oh, remember that?
Yeah.
He was the hot foot guy.
You can't do shit nowadays.
You can't do anything, no.
But no, it was interesting reading this Lenny, or listening, I should say, to the Lenny Dykstra book. He wasn't a partier back then when all the rest of the guys were. He started that shit when he went to Philly.
Oh, wow. No kidding.
Yeah, he didn't even start steroids until he went to Philly.
Well, he got the money, so he had
he
to
went
keep
from
it
150 to 160 pounds when he was playing with the Mets, and the first year at the Phillies, he went all the way up to 190 pounds, and everyone's looking at him like, "What the fuck?" But it wasn't illegal.
No, it wasn't.
And then they slowly introduced penalties for steroids in baseball. Then there was a time where they're like, "You shouldn't be doing steroids, but we're not going to check the players anytime soon." And then eventually they had to go all in, unfortunately. But he's all about it. He's like, I did steroids. I'm proud of it. Everyone knew it was fucking going on. The owners, the players, everybody knew that it was great for baseball.
Well, you had said the other day that in the book, he said, you know, how am I supposed to feel bad about it if the team-sanctioned doctor is giving me a prescription?
Right.
So how am I doing something wrong?
Right.
If I'm just going down to the pharmacy and get my prescription
And
filled.
He's basically going, look, I knew if I did steroids, I could be making $10 million a year. If I didn't make steroids, there was a good chance I would be leaving baseball and just getting a regular job. Mm-hmm. And Lenny's like, I did not want that life for myself.
So we got this guy today, the secret,
Gary Byrne, yeah.
And I started looking through his book, and I was really annoyed that he wrote it, but it's very good.
Mm.
It's like just as getting information out there, the interesting stuff about the White House and some of the nuts they have to deal with.
Right.
Really interesting, and a little bit of biographical stuff, but, you know, I don't care if he's Irish and Lebanese or whatever it is, but just the fucking, it's good, man, so I'm just looking at him a fox, so I'm enjoying it more than I thought I would.
When I start a book and it says, I was born in blah, blah, blah. I know. Fast forward 50 pages. I'm good.
My grandfather immigrated. No one cares. My daddy.
I was born a poor black child.
And my daddy worked at the local paper mill. My mama was a school teacher. Who gives a fuck? Right.
Walked uphill both ways.
Right.
Coming and going. Walked uphill both ways in the sleet and the hailstorm.
And some of these people get that shit. And their history, they'll make it very quick, like a quick 10 pages. Da, da, da. All right, we know this is what you want to know. So here we go. Let's get into it. Oh, when they start with that dribble.
Yeah,
he did not
like these the Clintons.
Yeah, well, he was a Bush guy, right?
Big time. And again, so I think politics plays into it, too.
You got to think. I think, I don't know. I don't think it's cool to be writing the book like that.
I want to ask him, how did he not sign an NDA?
Yeah.
That's the best, especially... I'm going to start laughing from you doing it the other day. So you've got to steer it back the other way because I think you're going to go into the Clinton.
No.
Oh, that was
that was fucking priceless.
It's beyond funny.
Monica, don't worry about it.
It's beyond funny.
Don't worry about it.
People said it sounded just like him.
It was the perfect.
They said we thought it was actually him.
Uncanny.
Said, no.
Yeah.
You know, Daryl Hammond does a good Clinton, but not until little Jim Norton fucking threw down the other day.
He's coming in soon, so.
Oh, picking out a thermos. thermos. Not an ordinary thermos for you. And a rear end thermometer, too.
Great fucking movie.
The Jerk. The Jerk is a great movie.
Thermos for you.
Not an ordinary.
Oh no, she's gonna leave with shit.
The extra best thermos you can buy with vinyl and stripes and a cup filled right in. I'm picking out a thermos for you and maybe a barometer too. And what else can I buy so on me you'll realize a rear end thermometer too.
That's awesome.
What an awful gift.
She's leaving him.
Or not. Or not. Maybe it's the perfect gift.
So funny that he's thinking that he's going to pick out a thermos for her as she's crying and packing her bags.
Isn't that the scene where she leaves the...
That's what she's acting.
She leaves the note, though, and then he reads it because the water... Because the water smeared it.
It's a
great scene.
Brilliant comedy.
It's one of the greatest movies of all time.
It's fucking hilarious. So
these good. Cans are exploding.
He hates these cans.
I am someone. My name's in print.
Yeah.
His book was really fucking good.
I didn't read it.
I have a new respect for Steve Martin because for a while there I was like, ugh.
My favorite part of it is like, why'd you stop doing stand-up? And he's like, Friday night, second show.
Yeah. Right. But he was doing arenas. You didn't have to do the second show anymore. Yeah. You just do a Thursday early show and go home.
But he also talks about when he was doing those arenas, he started seeing the empty seats.
Yeah,
not in the front,
yeah,
by the way.
No, right.
Way up in the boonies, and he's like, he knew that that wave for him was over, and he wanted to finish on top
because
he knew he was a fucking rocket ship with all that stuff.
I think, and again, bringing it all the way back to Alabama, I think one of the first times he did he took the crowd across the street and bought them French fries was, I think in Birmingham, Alabama was one of the first times he did that stunt.
Did he do that before Andy Kaufman did that stuff?
I don't know, I know he, in Birmingham, Alabama, he really did. He's like, well, if y'all want to go across the street, I'll buy everybody fries.
Yeah.
And everybody went with him. He had to buy like 1,500 people.
And that is
it was really cool. And he hung out.
That's the beauty of being me. I'd only have to buy like 15 to 16 things of fries.
One hundredth.
Yeah, I could give out cars at my shows.
So we got Gary Byrne, this Secret Service guy for the Clintons, coming in about less than an hour. So please stick around for that.
He had total access. Like, I mean, he was like the guy who they had to go through to get to the president.
But they're talking about that in the paper today because he was a uniform Secret Service guy, and a lot of people are saying the uniform guys didn't get as much access as the plain clothes.
No, it's called, I don't know, but it's the uniform division. There's,
right.
I think that they had the highest access, actually.
Oh. What kind of uniform? I didn't always.
It says Secret Service in bright yellow. And they had bright yellow jackets.
An orange deer hunter vest.
Yes.
I'm with the Prez.
Yeah. Yeah.
Written across the front.
Yeah. Prez Guard. It says on the back.
Prez Guard.
Yeah. PREZ. Really? Yeah. And they had nicknames for them. And Bill Clinton's nickname was Eagle. It's like, really? Could you have picked a more obvious nickname, Eagle?
I wonder who Eagle might be.
I don't know. Eagle should have been someone else, and then Hat Rack should have been the president. Yeah, we got Hat Rack in the hole coming. What the hell is that?
That's perfect. Exactly.
Wonderful.
Jim Norton needs to be in charge of security of the president of the United States.
Thank you very much, Vic.
I have just determined.
I've actually said that at the White House gate, and they didn't listen. I should be in charge here.
And they wouldn't go with that. Just tapped lightly on the window.
Yeah.
Hey, I just want to say.
She cursed a lot? That's his big reveal? That,
really?
That Hillary had tantrums and cursed a lot?
Jesus. Now she threw a vase at him. There's probably more.
Yeah, all right. We'll talk to Gary Burns a little bit.
A vase.
Did she really throw a vase?
He says she threw a Bible at the back of one of the agents' head, too.
Oh.
I didn't even read that part.
Sacrilege.
You ever swear on one?
Well, I mean, if you're going to go Bible beating, you got to go with Bill Monroe, father of bluegrass, beating his ex-wife with a Bible during their divorce proceedings.
Well, of course we do, Vic. What the fuck are you talking about?
If
we're going to go with book beatings.
Are we? That's the number one?
What? Bill Monroe, father of bluegrass, beat his ex-wife.
I wouldn't know that.
It's a hillbilly redneck fact. It's a classic rock and roll hillbilly.
Fair enough.
Bluegrass redneck fact.
I wrote notes for the Lenny Dykstra. You want to hear some more stuff?
Okay.
Well, we did the Mookie Wilson, had horrendous breath, so we got to ask him about Mookie.
Right.
He shared center field with Mookie Wilson. A lot of people don't know that. Another reason why Another reason why he left the Mets and went to the Phillies because he wanted to play every fucking day. Davey Johnson drank all the time. We did that one. Oil. This was interesting. So game seven of the 86 World Series, you forget the Buckner play was in the, you know, they had to play another fucking game.
That was, yeah.
Game six.
Yeah, game six, of course. And Oil Can Boyd was pissed off that he didn't get the call for game seven. So he went and started drinking.
Oh, right.
You knew this?
Well,
I forgot about
now
this.
Now that you
I
say
bought
it.
In the drinks.
So Oil Can Boyd doesn't get the call for game seven. He's like, fuck this. It's the World Series. This is crazy. He goes off and starts drinking.
Yeah, he's
going
up.
To E-Rock's point where they would just get away with it. They just did crazy ass shit back then.
Yeah.
So then they went to find him because they're like, well, we want to put Oil Can Boyd in this game. And he was too drunk to play game seven of the World fucking Series. That's crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is in my in the attic of my mind. I'm remembering a little bit of this. Yeah, it seems
sounds like a good poem. In the attic of my mind.
Oil Can Boyd.
Yes. That would be great. It's a really romantic poem, and Oil Can Boyd is the point of it. People are like, what the fuck's he talking
in the
about?
Attic of my mind, Oil Can Boyd. Totally forgot to. I'm remembering this as you're reading.
Who was the manager for the Red Sox? Because Lenny Dykstra explains.
Was that Don Zimmer?
No. Was it McNamara?
No, not maybe. I don't know. You both got me.
McNamara scares the shit out of Kennedy. You control McNamara, you control Kennedy.
Lenny Dykstra explains the Bill Buckner play. He said that, I think it was McNamara. Someone help me out with this. Late in the games, they would take Buckner out because he had fucked up ankles and he wasn't bending down as well. So later in the games, they would always take Buckner out. To make their defense a little stronger, but could you look this?
Yeah, it was McNamara. So. It is okay. John McNamara.
So
and don't get Leary started on this when he comes in here, by God.
Which will be later today as
well. He will lose his fucking mind on this. He used to have material about
but
this.
But they're trying
to, specifically
Lenny Dykes was saying, look, it's too bad. They'll always remember the Buckner play, but he was a great player. I think he batted 290 for his career.
An amazing player.
Yeah, but he said that McNamara wanted Buckner on the field to celebrate the moment. It was the only reason they kept him in the game. They said the whole year they would take Buckner out of the game late to make sure the defense was a little better, and he was even taking him out of the World Series in earlier games.
So the one time he put him in there for tribute's sake,
yeah, because he wanted him on the field like this is your fucking moment. That's how Lenny Dykstra explains it in his book.
Right. Well, we got Leary will know this. This will be wonderful.
Which I found fascinating. I never really
heard that angle
before.
That's crazy.
What happened? I mean, I've never seen this. This is okay. Boy, at the end of the game,
and he's like,
there he goes.
Yeah.
Wow.
Between his fucking legs.
It just never ceases to amaze me. Every time this happens, I expect him to get it.
Yeah.
Isn't that weird how that happens?
Oh, boy.
We were talking about Rob Bartlett yesterday, and I was working with Rob Bartlett, who's a huge Mets fan, when this happened. We were in Toledo, Ohio, and I could get backstage because the gig was in a hotel. And so I was going up and down to my room watching the game, and I'd come down on the elevator and run behind the stage, and he'd wander back to the curtain and do a big laugh, and then I'd go, they've tied it up. Right. I was whispering to him between the, I'll never forget it as long as I live.
Wait a minute. Let me ask you a question. Was that game, would that have been the end of the World Series if that happened?
Yes.
Yes.
Boston was supposed
to win.
The
Red Sox would have broken the Bambino heads at that moment.
And that's why they kept Buckner in.
Were they mad at Bill Buckner?
They got over it.
Yeah, and like 42 years later, right? After he left the state and the country and had to live on a beach in Hana, Oahu,
right,
for like 12 years or somewhere in the middle of nowhere, but you know,
but and then also in the book, Kevin Mitchell, who played for the Mets in that game six with the big comeback. Kevin Mitchell, they were trying to find him to put him in the game, and he was booking his flight home.
He had given up, too.
Cornell and Lenny Dykstra were like, and now we're looking for Kevin Mitchell.
Can't find him.
And they're like,
can't find old Ken Boyd, can't pitch game seven.
And he was on the phone.
Going, get my ass out of here.
Yeah, getting his flight ready to get the fuck out and go home. So this book, the Lenny Dykstra book's all right, man. It's all right. I'm trying to find what else I wrote down about it.
You were looking for a new read the other day, so it seems like you've gotten into it.
Yeah, it was for the show, but now I'm kind of enjoying it.
That's, I can
steroids
hear
that. In baseball. Everyone knew. We'll have to talk to him about that. And he thinks all those guys deserve to be in the Hall of Fame because because, you know.
Why not?
They just fucking knew that right. this was and those, and, bringing and, baseball back after the strike.
And like we said earlier, it was not illegal. You know, they started implementing at a really slow rate what you're allowed to do and not to do at that time. So, fuck it.
And, and then another guy that got addicted to drugs because they gave him Vicodin. He had a horrible car accident in Philly.
Yeah.
And he bruised his heart, broke some ribs, some other injury.
I had that after a relationship ended. My heart was bruised.
Darren Dalton, right.
What did with Darren Dalton? I think.
And he bruised his heart in the car accident. And the doctors basically said if he wasn't on steroids, he probably would have died. Most people would die from that injury. But because of the steroids, it supposedly saved him. That's what he's saying in the book. But that started his Vicodin addiction. They give him the fucking Vicodin for the pain, and next thing you know, you're fucking addicted to this shit.
Yeah. Goddamn pills, America.
I've heard that story a million fucking times, and it drives me nuts.
I'm with you 1,000,000%.
These fucking doctors just write that prescription like it's no big fucking deal. They know how serious that shit is. Then he talks about gambling. All right, what else? And then the Charlie Sheen secret room we got to get into.
Ooh, that's in the book?
Yeah, he went to Charlie Sheen's house because he was trying to, you know, help Charlie Sheen. And they're like, you're never going to find him. And he's like, what are you talking about? This is his house. And it's like, yeah, he's in his secret room. And then finally he was able to get into the secret room.
It's probably behind the bookcase. I want a room like that.
He pretty much said dance.
There's a way. Is there a pole?
No, I just go there to dance.
Just free form.
You push the bookcase and it opens and I go in the back and you hear music faintly coming and I'm back there dancing. I'm writing a movie about that.
All kinds of music?
What are you?
The Dancing Boy in the Wall.
What kind of music are you dancing to?
Just whatever it is, classical, club, whatever is contemporary.
Classical or club.
Yeah, The Dancing Boy in the Wall.
That allows for multiple sequels, changing the music.
Absolutely. The Dancing Boy in the Wall, hip-hop.
Dancing Boy in the Wall, bluegrass. Dancing Boy in the Wall, polka.
That's right. I have six so far. Yes. Koran Versus is the one that no one wants to buy.
Well, The Secret Room is exactly that. Pretty much. He said he felt like he was like in a James Bond movie or something.
That's pretty cool.
And then he had all sorts of crazy ass memorabilia in there, including, I think he said, one of Babe Ruth's rings.
Oh, is that more like, is that like a panic room almost that he put memorabilia in?
I don't know.
I have a panic room. It's called my whole apartment.
He was in there partying though.
So that's about it. We'll talk to Lenny Dykstra tomorrow. And then it comes out in the paper today that he's sort of a gigolo or something?
Yeah.
What the hell is that about?
I don't know. I'm going to ask him about his penis, though.
Now?
Yeah.
Or then?
Yeah, supposedly.
It'd be better if it's now.
He was hinting that he, you know.
That's what he does.
He hangs out with older ladies that want a little dick.
Fine. Fred Garvin.
Well, you might want to rephrase that. He probably doesn't look at it like that. Hanging out with older ladies that want a little dick.
a lot of dick. Want a lot of dick, right?
I think he told Howard all that stuff. It's in the paper today, so. And there's one lady in her 80s that he's bothered by because she, you know, puts her tongue down his throat or something. This Lenny Dykstra has lived a life. My God. Is his son in the majors?
I know
his son was drafted.
I got zip.
Yeah, I got zip on that. I probably should have Googled it.
I know Pete Rose Jr. tried him. That's all I got. There he is.
He fell a little short. Cutter, right? Cutter Dykstra? Who married Jamie Lynn Sigler. Yeah. Is he still in the majors? I know he's drafted. I don't know much about his son. Whatever. Okay.
Were you from such a white trash area that when they would refer to the lesbians, they just go, she's a Lenny Dykstra?
No.
That's a
fucking good one.
No, it's not. It's not at all. Don't even pretend. But I'm saying no.
I don't think I ever heard that.
Oh, I had a bunch of idiot friends, and that's what that was their go-to for, you know, she's wearing a tool belt.
Oh, he's doing a little AAA action, I think, Cutter Dykstra.
Oh.
And then he has another son that was drafted?
Yeah, the Atlanta Braves.
Jeez. He's got two sons that are sort of in it.
Oh, they ought to change their last name to the Baseballers or something. Sweet.
The Rounders.
Oh, you got food?
Yeah, man.
Then let's eat.
And then we should come back. We should mention the turkey murders.
I saw that. I'm like, what do we even mention? It's just so fucking sad.
Yeah.
How's this going to stop? The world's got to get fed up with this, right?
Yeah.
Everybody loves a gun.
39 dead. And this is bombs.
Huh?
This is not guns. This is bombs.
Yeah, there's a... But now they're saying that
he shot into the crowd. He shot before he flew off the bombs. He totally had a rifle and fired into the crowd.
But not, they're saying this is not smart because ISIS sort of needs Turkey because that's one way they're getting these guys in.
Well, good. I hope they fuck themselves and do our job for us.
Well, that's sort of, they're like, they kind of need Turkey.
Well, good.
Because that's one way they're getting these guys in.
Yeah, but Turkey doesn't need them, maybe.
No
hopefully.
Kidding. What the fuck?
Every time we think they do something that screws them, it just doesn't.
Right.
Because it's just individual people.
It makes no fucking sense, right.
There's no organization. It's like they had a big meeting and decided to do Turkey. It's just a couple guys say, let's do that, and then they tribute to ISIS. They go, that was us.
Terrorist organization is an oxymoron, even though it's not. But it seems to be sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah, we could certainly talk a little more about that after the break.
Yeah, it's just depressing.
Jimmy is off for a couple weeks, back on the road, jimnorton.com for the dates, right?
Yeah, I'll be in Fargo and Edmond, Oklahoma, and Minneapolis coming up. And check out the new UFC podcast with Matt Serra. The next one's up tomorrow.
Edmond's Oklahoma City, though, right?
Yep. That's it. Yeah, yes, okay, it is.
And Vic?
I'm at Nantucket Comedy Festival July, and Comedy Off Broadway in Lexington, Kentucky, first week of August.
All right, right on. Got a busy show today. We also have the cast of Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll coming in studio in the 10 o'clock hour.
Yes.
That show, of course, stars our pal, Bob Kelly.
Yes.
He's the star of that show. Don't be confused by the whole Dennis Leary angle. That's Bob Kelly's show. So the first two episodes, it's very, very good. Did you see a little of the Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll, Jimmy?
Not of this season, I haven't, no. They had asked me to do the town hall.
Right.
But I had a possible shoot today.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I didn't want to say yes and then have to cancel it last minute.
Right.
But of course, then I did my shoot yesterday, so.
Yeah.
That's a busy actor working right there.
Yes.
No, it's just desperate.
it was
very busy, short, the whole thing.
Busy slash desperate.
Yeah, it was with Pete Holmes and Artie Lang, actually. It was for Pete's show.
Nice.
It was quick. I mean, again, I was only shooting, but they, Judd Apatow tends to work fast.
Right.
That's good to know.
No nonsense. He's like, all right, we got this
thing. He knows what he wants, and that's it. And I very rarely provide it.
I like Sex, Drugs, and Rock and Roll. And the first two episodes were very, very good. A little lesbian action, a little threesome action.
No, there you go.
If I was Dennis, all I would do is write fucking threesome. Is Dennis in a threesome?
Yes, he is.
Of course he is.
Is he?
That's
okay.
All I would do is write threesome stuff.
But there's a nice little, I'll just keep it at that. Yes, he is.
Okay.
I don't want to give any spoilers away. That's why I don't like seeing these things ahead of time, because then you want to talk about this stuff before the other people have had an opportunity to see it.
Oh, Bob.
What, Bob shirtless?
Dancing around?
Oh, there he is. Bob. There you go.
Yeah, Bobby, the first two episodes, he's got some lines, man. He's got some good stuff so far. Good for Bobby. And Dennis Leary and everybody else in that damn thing. They're all coming in here, so.
I always enjoy when I see everybody do things better than me. Which is daily.
That's called cuckolding.
Actually, that's the only area where that does not apply. But
are you a good lay?
I'm fine. Oh, I'm fucking amazing. Are you kidding me? Yeah.
What makes you amazing?
Everything I do.
Okay.
Wow, you're cocky.
I'm fucking lutely.
Since I was a fool. Good for you, Vic.
Yeah.
Kelly.
No, I got. Yeah.
Can you keep your rod? Can you keep an erection in a condom?
Yep. I can do anything. No, yes is the answer to every question you're going to ask me.
You like a dick in your eye?
Yeah, absolutely. But you got to tease me with it first. You got to lube the eye and then rub it around a little bit.
Put some clear stuff on the lashes. Show you who's boss.
Exactly. And then I'm completely willing. Everything's fine.
Oh,
after
really?
That.
Look at the confidence.
I don't know how
Vic
we got into this, but
good
yeah.
for Vic. I admire that confidence.
Hey, what the fuck? Hey, that's how I grew up.
I have just the opposite feeling sexually.
Yes.
So you gonna fuck me hard? I don't know.
I don't know. Going to Beaky Buzzard.
I don't know.
Yours is better than mine.
Thank you.
I didn't think you would.
Oh boy, if I said that to women.
I used to love doing that voice.
that's fabulous. Okay. That's really good. I thought you had no skills.
Fuck.
Now I know you do a mean beaky buzzard.
Okay. Yeah. So, well, we'll see Dennis Leary and the gang a little later today. Season 2 premieres on FX tomorrow night at 10 p.m. Once again, I had a problem with their links that they send us. I'm like, what am I going to do with your dumb show? I don't mean it in that way. I like the show, but...
I know what you're saying.
In our jobs, we're lucky enough to see stuff ahead of time because they want you to prepare for these interviews. And then all of a sudden they send you a link and they...
Want to get away? It turns into want to get away.
But they sent this link like two or three weeks ago and they go, this link is only available for the next like, 2 days.
Yep.
So you got to see the show in that 2 day period, I guess. But I have other things I got to do. For the radio show and in my regular life.
He's taking acting lessons, dancing lessons. He's going to be a big star.
So finally, I'm like, I got time to watch this thing last night. And they're like looking at the link. Oh, my God, that expired a long time ago. And then you go back and forth with these people. And then finally, I'm like rolling. What username and password do I need right now to see the show?
I know they chose to send the publicist. Fucking mousy zilch. Man,
that's a pretty good rolling. That's
exactly.
Not bad.
It's amazing. The best impressions I do are of people that
no one knows at all. That's the bane of my existence, too. If Richie Tinkin from the comic strip was... I wish he was more famous because then I would have $12 million for imitating him.
Oh, you could do him.
Yeah, because... he talks like this. He's had throat cancer. So
very good Richie Tinkin.
Yeah, you can't understand it.
I used to manage Eddie Murphy back in the day. I don't even know. Jim Nose, I'm funny. God, Jim Nose, I'm funny fucking guys.
I haven't heard Richie talk much in the last few years, but when I did hear him, that does sound like
That's how he sounds.
Are you coming to the Christmas party? Are you coming to the Christmas party?
That's kind of creepy.
That's,
you nailed it.
That was my Tuesday.
Yeah. But anyway, I was going back and forth.
Sorry.
And rolling for an hour and then finally got the link. And I'm glad I got to see a couple episodes.
I could have just given you the DVD.
It's just frustrating because I'm like, what am I going to do with your show? What? I'm going to make copies. I'm going to put it online. I'm going to go sell it in Chinatown. Just give me the fucking link.
They've just had that weird stuff happen. And they get, it's like now they've gone too far the other direction where they're trying to protect it so much.
Right.
And it's like, there's got to be a better way to do it. But
and then they force you to do a password that you'll never remember. And I'm stupid enough where I don't write it down.
I'll fall for
it. You know what my password is?
God,
I'll even tell you.
Yeah.
Huh? Strawberry gelato.
uppercase, lowercase, three numbers, then something that's not a number or a letter.
Right,
and then
the symbol for helium.
Right. A word, spell a word backwards in there as well. It's just enough.
The number 6 in the Cyrillic alphabet.
Is there anything worse than when you do a password? They're like, one letter has to be capital. I don't want to capitalize one letter.
No,
all right, N.
Right. I found this little story in the paper. Old timer and suicide leap. I just like how this article ends. It says, elderly man, it's very tragic, obviously. He jumped to his death from the upper level of the Staten Island Mall, landing on the ground floor in front of horrified shoppers. The 84-year-old man crashed down in front of a Foot Locker store at about 11:30 a.m., and the last line is wonderful. It wasn't immediately clear why he jumped. He was 84 years old, and he fucking had it. That's why he jumped.
It wasn't immediately
I don't know
clear.
Anything about this guy, but I guarantee he fucking had it.
I don't think you have a psychology degree, but I agree with you.
Right.
I don't know.
Probably had some ailments and probably watched everyone die around him that he loved.
Yeah. Maybe he couldn't get the LeBrons he wanted.
Before it was something trite like that.
Could have been an impulse, right. It could have been an impulse.
Also, these fucking guys... He had it.
He was just showing off to impress a chick. There was some 25-year-old girl.
Which is a sweet Staten Island move, by the way. If you're in Staten Island, that will get you a girl. Watch me fling myself off this goddamn balcony.
Oh, right on.
You got balls to do off the second floor.
Yeah, yeah. I mean...
Because you're not sure you're going to die.
He landed on his head. Yep.
Landed on his head. That'll do it.
You got a mean
man thud.
Yeah. You're brittly, though. I bet you,
Oh, yeah.
Second floor will take care of that.
Hopefully.
84.
But the last line wasn't immediately clear why he jumped. Are you kidding me?
He was upset about the England-Iceland game.
Right.
He was a former British, you know, expatriate.
Talk to any 84-year-old. They've had it.
Oh, every day of their life.
They fucking have had it.
Every day of their life. My grandmother and her sister looked after me when I was little, and I was 7, and they were 84 and 88, and that's all they ever talked about every day was, I just wish Jesus would come take me. Right. I just wish ever
Are
God.
Are they still alive?
Yeah, they're both still. They're 127 years old.
He was 7 at the time.
So, yes, actually, you can look them up on the Guinness Book of World Records as the two oldest women on the planet Earth right now.
Yeah, at that point, everything fucking hurts on you.
But
all your loved ones have died.
But when my mom starts drifting that way, and she's 83 now, it bums me out. And that's how I steer her back onto the path. I always go, I'm like, now you're sounding like Granny so-and-so and Aunt so-and-so. And my mom will go, okay, I'm back.
Oh, I'm back?
Yeah, but she gets a little sad every now and then and says that. She says, why am I doing? What am I doing? I just do the same thing every day. I don't do anything. Right. It's fucking boring.
That's what I say.
You do a lot, my friend.
I do the same thing every day. I wake up,
don't.
I come here, I go home. Right. Occasionally I do my advice show. I go out, I do a set, I model, I go home.
What do you model for?
Just whatever people want. I'll just
Cabs?
Stop. Yeah, that's how I make extra money. I'll just go up to people and go, you need a model for anything? I'm your man. Sometimes they'll say yes, sometimes they say no, thank you, sir.
You would make a fucking fortune if you modeled your calves.
I should model my hiney. I have a very modelable hiney.
I've seen it.
Thank you very much.
Got a nice hiney?
I've seen it.
It's plump.
You haven't seen the website?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
www.jimshiney.com.
That's right. But there's a hyphen in between Jim's
Sorry.
Hiney. That's why
Sorry.
I don't find it.
Sorry.
Oh.
It used to be .org because he was, you know, public service.
I wish I could take more fingers in my butt. I don't want to talk about this now, but I can only take like one before I go like, ha ha ha.
Wait, what happened?
You have to do the Ralph Cramden phenomena.
Are you taking fingers in your butt on a regular basis now?
No. I just can't.
No.
Yeah, no, I can only take a little bit, a little pressure. I like
pinky?
The idea of it.
Just a pinky.
No, I'm more than a pinky, but not much more. Good strap.
You got Travis on that one.
I just remember years ago, Jim telling his story of the first time a girl tried to put a strap on in him, and he had to stop because he felt like he was going to shit.
Yeah,
more than still one of my favorite stories.
It's true.
Sounds like he's gotten over that, though, Travis.
Well, you know, practice makes
gleefully.
Yeah. Right. He goes, you bet I have. Jazz hands. All right.
Good for Jim. You put your mind to something.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I've always
admired. That's what I do. I just yell, I can do it. I can do it. They're like, what? I'm like, forget it.
It's his middle name, Focus.
That's right.
Jim Focus Norton.
Yeah.
Oh, this guy dumped shit in the pool.
Is that what slurry is?
Yeah, vile slurry.
Suspect dumped vile slurry in pool.
Now I got shit behind me.
Vile slurry
read.
Is a great name for a band.
Yes.
I was going to say, that was my 9th grade girlfriend, Vile Slurry.
Excuse me.
Angered over his recent eviction from a mobile home park, a Florida man carrying a 5-gallon bucket allegedly snuck back into the property and contaminated the community swimming pool with a vile slurry that had the appearance of liquid feces diarrhea. Ugh. According to investigators, Thomas Lee targeted the Thursday night, told cops, saw. All right.
He looks like a man who would dump liquid shit into a bathing area.
He's fucking had it.
I love him. That's what I would do if they threw me out of some place and there was a pool. If there's a pool and a bucket of shit and you throw me out of that place, I'm going to make those things one.
Perfect storm is what you're saying.
Sir, dude, how do you not dump shit in a pool if you're evicted?
I'm with you.
You're coming back.
What are you supposed to do? Salt it?
Coming back with a bucket.
Yeah. What city?
Somewhere in Florida.
Well, entering the Clearwater Park.
Okay, so that's Tampa.
Tampa
area, Clearwater. Right, okay.
Yeah.
Right.
That leads us to the Red Cross apologizing for the swim safety poster.
Oh, I saw that.
That some decided was racist.
I saw that. It's
Why was it racist again? I looked quickly and I was like, I don't fucking have time for this nonsense.
Because it's like six do's and don'ts, and every don't in the picture, every don't arrow happens to be pointed at the kid that's a cartoon black person.
I saw a white dude that had the don't too.
Okay, maybe. Okay,
let me see it.
Here.
Right. It's silly.
No one did this on fucking purpose.
Hell no.
No. But no, it said don't marry. And it points to the black guy. That's wrong. Don't hire.
I saw a white dude. There's a white dude. See, not cool.
Not good.
See?
Good.
White dude.
Not cool.
Right there. No, you're right.
And then there's a white.
No, you're right. A little girl.
Little girl, not cool. Right. So what are they talking
Wait
about?
Wait a minute. Hold on. Not cool.
not cool that the black guy is attempting to swim? Is that what that one is?
No, he's jumping over the white girl, and I don't go for that either.
What do you mean? Why is this black kid not cool?
You should always swim around the white girl politely. Never jump over. No, I don't know.
Why is this one not cool for
real? You're not supposed to dive.
Oh, here's why it's not cool.
He's not diving.
The black girl is pushing the white girl in the pool, not cool. The white guy is cool holding the baby. Not cool is the black guy next to him. The two black kid, the white kid swimming, no problem. The one white guy, not cool.
Because he's got a drink in his hand.
The one is the white guy, the white kid chasing a black kid. So there's two not cool white
people. Yeah, there are. You're right.
People.
Yeah. It's 50-50. It's 50-50, it looks like.
No, there's the white kid chasing the black kid. The white kid's not cool.
Right.
The glasses with the sunglasses with the drink is a white kid, not cool.
Two.
And then the female,
that's the black girl's
pushing
her.
You're right.
So it's three black not cools. To two white not cools.
Who the fuck pays attention to this shit?
But
that's exhausting.
America. How do they say that's racist?
Because it's 3-2. There's
five.
Because you see what you want.
Huh? Yeah.
You see what you want to see.
But why is this...
What groveling fucking... What,
you're
this
right.
Is, by the way, in
Here
this moment,
go.
This is what people like about Trump. And I know to bring it, it's little shit like this that we're bludgeoned with it every day. I could see if it was like 5-1.
Right.
3-2.
3-2.
And aren't both cools pointed towards white people?
Wait, are they?
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why.
You see what you want to see. If you want to see it as racist,
how's diving not cool? Yeah. The fucker's just diving.
Well, that pool, they say you can't dive in the pool.
No, I know.
But it has
that's
a diving board.
Fucking angers me to this. No, I've been all summer long. I've been yelling and screaming that they've taken the fun. I dove in the pool with the kids a couple of weeks ago, and the fucking lifeguard yelled at me for diving
off a diving board.
Yes, off a 3-meter springboard. And I went right off, and I did like a flip and a one
Wait,
and a
you're
half.
You're not allowed to
no,
dive
you can't
off
dive
a diving
anymore.
Board.
You can't dive anymore.
So take the diving board away.
Well, no shit. You can't, but that's it's. They've ruined the fucking pool.
And what is this kid? I still don't know why he's not cool in the middle.
Because he's looking for some dick and nobody will put it in his mouth, apparently.
Oh, I see.
I really don't know. He's clearly gobbling for cock right there and nobody will give him one.
Well, mind my business.
Oh, maybe so, is he pushing another kid under the water? Is that?
Well,
I don't know.
You can't see it if that's
not
the case.
Not cool. Wait a minute.
Because he's yelling and being rowdy, maybe?
No, he's just swimming.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. He's got a googly eyed face and his mouth is open.
The bottom line is when you look in the middle of the poster, you have white girl cool,
that's what it is,
black kid not cool, black kid not cool, white guy cool. In the middle of the poster, to find where the white people aren't cool, it's a little harder. It's the one guy. They might have mixed it up better, but it wasn't because they're racist.
No, correct. God.
And they were trying to put people of color in this so they're represented. It's exhausting.
And they have one of each lifeguard. But again, the Red Cross apologizing. Oh, we're sorry.
Gonna change it. Take it down.
Of course they are. That's why people like Trump. All you people out there that are fucking buckling to this nonsense, that's what's attractive about him.
Yeah. The cartoon poster showed children playing in a swimming pool, obviously. Nearly all of the white children activities were labeled as cool, when the children of color were depicted acting in unsafe ways and were labeled not cool. That's not totally true.
Correct.
We went three.
The children of color. Okay.
Oh, God.
Well,
I mean, look. That's ridiculous.
Margaret Sawyer. Thank you, Margaret Sawyer.
Exactly.
Thank you,
hello,
Margaret
Tom
Sawyer.
Hey, Margaret Sawyer, you mean strike. Right. Great song
like
by
it.
Rush.
I
Thank
like
you.
It.
Very good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're good both Canada. With you. Good Canada.
That's right.
Thank God we got someone like Margaret Sawyer out there.
Paying attention to the important stuff
Absolutely.
In life.
Absolutely.
Who first saw the poster, and then again, so she's seen it in a couple of different locations in Colorado. She said she first thought it was outdated, that it couldn't be a recent poster. My God. A Red Cross spokesman says the posters have since been removed and more appropriate material is being developed.
Oh, good. More
Thank
appropriate
you, Margaret.
Material. Margaret Sawyer getting things done. Do you hear what Madge Sawyer did? She got the posters taken down with all the blacks misbehaving in the pool.
It's like you got Madge. People forget that Margaret can be shortened to Madge.
Madge.
Wait, would Tom Sawyer, but not cool for his friend, Jim?
I don't know. This is a...
What are you writing?
Paul's riffing.
Tom Sawyer, his friend Jim, would he be labeled not cool by the Red Cross
poster?
Oh!
Mark Twain. I like it.
I did too. I incorrectly wanted to just throw my coffee on you.
No,
I was
shit.
Wrong.
Me too. All right. We were all prepared to pounce right there, and the fucker pulls out a Twain reference.
And then that old story where they took the word out of the book.
Oh, that's awesome. That's the stupidest
fuck?
Thing.
Just
right?
Don't read the fucking
what
book.
Made
that's
the
how
fucking
the guy
book.
Exactly.
Right.
They took nigger out of the Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer.
You remember that story? We did that a couple years back.
You know.
Can't do that.
Not at all. They should have added word.
Should be more nigger.
That should be his name too.
Extra nigger Jim instead of just nigger Jim.
It's amazing that they're removing stuff from literature. I mean, like, it's an unpleasant word, sure, and generationally it seems weird, but that's what it's like. They don't edit Mein Kampf.
No?
To take out the fucking, whatever it was, Hitler wrote. I've never read it.
You can't edit the old
I've gotten in trouble for being... I've been out in America, you know, doing this and saying, come see me at the comedy show. And they're like, who do you like? And I'm like, you know, Richard Pryor came out in 76 with Bicentennial Nigger. And that's the name of the record.
And
everybody in the fucking room takes a deep breath and looks at me like I'm some kind of freakazoid. I'm like, it's the name of the goddamn... Right. If you know anything about Pryor, he put the N-word in the title of every record
right
he ever did.
Right after you say that, they go, thanks for coming
see
by.
Right,
so we'll see you at the Atomic Club
Friday. Whether it be that nigger's crazy or Bicentennial Nigger, that was a prior trademark, and yet you know you can't say
he did it because he knew it was a shocking word, and he also knew that it was a shocking image. And on a biography on A&E one time, they blurred out the word. And it's like you're doing a biography on this comic genius,
and then you blur out.
He did that because he knew that it meant something.
And it's kind of important to the fucking story, don't you think?
On purpose.
It's so stupid. Then don't do the story then.
Yeah, it's totally disgusting and stupid.
Yeah.
And this poster is just
good album.
Dumb and stupid.
Great album. Yeah, really
but we got Margaret Sawyer out there making sure everyone is in their safe spaces.
Sitting around in Salida, Colorado.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, wherever you are.
Do we have any dental floss off the subject? I ate something and it's driving me nuts the whole time. We're talking. I'm picking up my tubes.
I would go toothpick.
A toothpick would be fun.
Let's get a toothpick for Jim Norton. We got a big interview coming up with the Secret Service guy any minute now. Gary Byrne, who works for the Clintons.
I saw Roland sneak him into the building, which was really funny. It was funny to watch the Secret Service guy get
in. He's here?
I saw Roland roaming around like a Secret Service guy trying to get him in here somewhere.
Roland!
He's more important people than that.
We'll have him in a couple minutes, I'm sure.
Yeah, bring him right in.
Yeah, so that poster is a big deal today, which is so dumb. I don't have time for that shit.
It does look like, now to the lady, the one point that she does make, it does look like something from the 70s.
Yes.
It does have the outdated look about it. But
sure it
other than that, I'm not with her on any of her idiotic points.
Mm.
Now, this is just, you're selectively looking for something to fuck with.
And they were trying to be polite. One white lifeguard, one black lifeguard. Well, a black girl pushing white girl in the pool, not cool. White boy chasing black boy, not cool. So they're trying to show like a white kid misbehaving with a black kid. And although every single interaction is a white and a black interaction. Like, why can't you have two black people doing something?
Or
two white people?
Yeah, that's a little weird too. But then there are 1, 2, 3, 4 black kids that are fine in this poster. Totally fine.
Now this is really someone that smoked some of that. She smoked some of that good coffee. She had some edibles.
Tobacco.
She had some of those left-handed cigarettes. and then started focusing.
Why is there a floating whale, by the way? There's a floating whale with a whistle.
Yeah, well, aren't you bothered by the floating whale?
Yes, a tiny whale. A tiny blue whale.
But Margaret grabbed her pen and paper and she jotted it down. Let's see, we got one. Two.
I don't know what this is. I have no idea what that little...
It's his foot.
Maybe? He's a tall guy.
Why does it just say, not cool? What's he doing wrong?
I don't know. That's what I've been asking.
Yelling. Maybe
I
his mouth.
Know.
His mouth is open, so maybe they're saying he's being crazy and yelling.
So
I don't
weird.
Know.
Like, I don't understand
I
what
think
he's
pushing a white kid's head.
Underneath the water?
Someone underwater. Okay.
That's what I'm thinking.
But maybe you don't see it. Then the foot should be white. Then the back of the foot coming out of the water should be white if he's drowning a white child.
Yeah, with the unbelievability of that, a black kid drowning a white kid. I mean, who would buy it?
Never.
The fucking blue whale floating is more believable.
Mm. He's got the mouth of the blow-up doll. That's all that's going on. It's the mouth of a blow-up doll.
I didn't even know you can't dive off diving boards anymore.
Now that I learned
that's
that
ridiculous.
Last summer. I was so fucking mad last summer when I figured that out.
You got to get rid of the diving boards.
You can't hardly... You can't... Well, they've ruined all the fun at the pool.
Well, too many people are breaking their fucking necks.
It's liability. I know.
They didn't figure out the pools
fucking
properly.
Stupid, too many people
did that dive and bam, dove a little too far.
Well, that's what happens to you out in the country.
Too quickly.
You know, the old swimming hole thing.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Larry, what are you doing in studio?
Thank you, buddy. Bringing Norton some dental floss.
Oh, thank you, Larry.
Asking you shall receive.
Mm-hmm. I need a little dental floss.
I need a Filipino boy with mind skills.
Cool, not cool.
Let's bring me in a telepathic Filipino boy. We're going to make requests for weird shit.
All right. It's chasing, maybe the white kid is, we don't even need to take phone calls.
No, it's stupid. Yeah, it's just stupid.
Yeah.
We spend
way
too much time.
They have a Jewish guy that just says, not cool. That's in a book. And they have Christ being drowned. I mean, that's rude.
Well, he clearly can walk on water.
Now I see her point. All right. Is Gary here? I don't know if we, what is Roland doing down there?
He's standing there.
Is he with Gary?
No.
Should we take a quick break? Why don't we take a quick break, Jimmy, so then we can set the field nice.
Let him fix his teeth.
Gary? He's here.
He's here. He's doing a quick phoner first.
Oh, he's doing a quick phoner, so we'll do a quick break. We're going to have the Secret Service guy that has a tell-all book on the Clintons. We'll have him in very, very shortly, so stay right where you are. Told you we'd be right back. Jim Norton went to leak. Got Gary Byrne. We're just waiting for him to come down the hall so we can talk to him for a little while. Then later we got Dennis Leary and
Bobby Kelly.
Well, I was going to say, and the star of sex, drugs, sex and drugs and rock and roll. There you go. Bob Kelly. Yes. Season 2 premieres on FX tomorrow night at 10 p.m.
He's going to the bathroom. I just saw him. He was waiting to use the restroom real quick. He'll probably be out in a minute. He was waiting for the...
So you just saw him enter the bathroom. Did you run away? Because you didn't want him jotting everything down?
No, he didn't enter the bathroom. He was still waiting outside.
From your bathroom visit?
Yes, I went upstairs.
The Howard Stern detail has him waiting outside. He's not allowed in the lobby yet.
You enjoy that, don't
I
you?
Do. I thoroughly enjoy it. It's one of my favorite things of the past 6 months. Are you kidding me? To watch you as a grown man of some stature get put in timeout is hilarious to me.
I certainly have to wait for the king.
I love it.
To enter his area, then I'm allowed to come to work.
No,
that's just wonderful. Thank you, SiriusXM.
As the father of a young child, two young children, it's fun to watch.
You're right. We're in a very important part of this company. You're 100% right when you tell us that. Let's get Gary Byrne in here. He's right there.
He looks very Secret Service-ish, by the way.
Good morning, Mr. Byrne.
With this man.
How are you?
Hello.
Right there. Yes,
yes,
sir.
Yes, please. Sit down.
I'm fine. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Are you kidding me? You wrote a terrific book.
Thank you so much.
Yes. We've been hearing about it for the last few days. And
thank you.
These guys are actually reading it.
Oh, they, good.
This
good.
Is actual.
This is Grant, my co-writer. So,
hey, buddy, what's up?
It seems like a big, and I was saying this the other day on the air too. Is it a big breach of trust? You writing this, like it seems like, you know, even though I get why you'd be annoyed at the guy, it seems like that was kind of it feels sleazy to write it.
I get that, and
there, yeah, talking to the mic there, sir.
Yeah, so I get that. And technically, you're right. And if you'd have asked me 10 years ago, if you'd have described to me 10 years ago that somebody was doing this, I would have said the same thing you said. But as time went by, things changed. And as I was getting closer to retirement and it was becoming obvious that Mrs. Clinton was going to run for president, it scared me. And I think somewhere I clearly walked through a door of a different opinion. But... I want people to know that that what the real Hillary Clinton is like, and she is not a leader. And if you look with some common sense at the history of the Clintons, and you know, I've been working.
Wait, can I slow you down for a second? You got a little emotional there.
Yes, yeah, it's tough to talk about.
Why?
Yeah,
because you feel like you're violating the trust, maybe.
Sure.
See, now, right, I could tell. No, he's upset. It's
well, when you was there ever a point when you were working with the Bushes that you thought that you'd be in this position?
No, I never thought, even when I started with the Clintons, I never thought I would be in this position. I never thought, because of the president's behavior, that I would be forced to testify And I was the first Secret Service employee to be forced to testify against the president in a criminal investigation. I was subpoenaed six times.
For the Ken Starr stuff?
Right. And then I was eventually ordered by the Supreme Court justice to testify. Right. I didn't want anything to do with it. But, you know, if you don't follow the law and you're a police officer, they fire you and put you in jail.
So you feel like almost like this is a little payback. It started pissing you off and you're like, look, now I'm going to tell my side of the story.
No, that's not really it. No. It's not about paying back. It's about getting the truth out. And that's one of the things bothers me about politics. And when you see it from behind closed doors like I did, it's time that somebody knows the truth about somebody, some of these people, and certainly Mrs. Clinton. What I witnessed over those years and what I wrote in my book, Crisis of Character, is her behavior is dangerous. And she really doesn't seem – and here's a good example. She's running for president of the United States right now. She's under investigation by the FBI. That doesn't happen by accident, trust me. Two – she is this supposedly great lawyer and great worker and so smart, and she doesn't understand how she's supposed to use a government computer server. That's bizarre. That doesn't match up. Mm-hmm. It's you know, if you go back and if you look at all the rumors we heard about the Clintons from Arkansas and everybody poo-hooed it and said, oh, it's tabloid trash, you know, it's not true. It was all true.
Yeah.
Was his behavior not true? Is that not what we saw? Is that not why I got subpoenaed? And the same with Mrs. Clinton's behavior, where she does whatever she wants. Do as I say, not as I do.
How did you not sign an NDA? That's what I'm amazed at. How does the Secret Service not sign something saying that I'll keep this under my hat?
No, you're right. It didn't exist at the time.
No one was signing these things back in the day?
No, the CIA did.
Okay.
But the Secret Service did not. And I'm distraught over that. But
do you feel like you're betraying anything, an oath you took or an assumed level of trust when you took the job?
With the Secret Service, I do. I don't feel like I'm betraying the Clintons because let's face it. The truth is I'm in this position because of their behavior.
Mm. Now, your day-to-day job, what was it back in the day?
So I was a secret
back with the Clintons.
Yeah, so I was a Secret Service Uniform Division officer, and the Uniform Division as a whole does the counter sniper, the bomb sniffing dogs, and they man posts inside the White House, fixed posts. Mine was a post outside the Oval Office, and then there's posts on the fence line. We travel with the president in the United States and in foreign countries, running the metal detectors, that kind of stuff. If you were to come to the White House, you would be screened by the Secret Service Uniform Division before you come in. They'd check your ID. They'd run you through a metal detector, that kind of thing.
Did you have there are people saying that you did not have as direct access as you're saying. That's their comments. They're saying that you're exaggerating your access to the president.
So one of the groups that's saying that is the Retired Secret Service Agent Association. And their main job is to protect themselves and the Secret Service agents. Now, they're going to say whatever they have to discredit me, which is wrong, and I'm actually taking steps to stop their slander, but that's a separate story. But the truth of the matter is, if what they're saying is true, then why was I subpoenaed six times? And why is part of my history with the United States that I had to testify about the president's sexual behavior?
In fairness, and I'm not even saying you're wrong, I'm sure you know what you're talking about, the sexual behavior thing was like, I know it was a lawsuit and the whole, he lied under oath, but don't they all do that? Like, maybe Bush Sr. didn't, but aren't they all just kind of shitty in one way or another?
So I don't know that to be true, but I get what you're saying. But what I do know, as I detail in my book, Crisis of Character, I know what their behavior was, and I know what his behavior
was. Fair enough. It's good, by the way. What I've read of it,
thank you so much.
I was annoyed at the idea that you wrote it, and I'm reading it. I'm like, oh, this is good.
Yeah, I do.
It was real. The stuff just about the White House and what you guys deal with and what you stop, it's really, really well done.
Well, thank you so much.
And you could prove your access by pictures, I'm sure, over the years.
Sure, and I have. There's a couple in there, or one in there,
there's more than a couple. You got a few good shots in there.
So that picture, can I talk about that picture for a minute?
Which one again? Let me see. Yeah, of course.
So in the background is President Clinton. He's standing in the dining room.
Right.
And the reason this picture is really significant to me.
It's right at the beginning of the book, by the way, for the people.
Yeah. And that's that door is right down the, like 150 feet down from where the Oval Office door is. And that's the dining room door. And he was coming down the hallway. And the significant thing about that picture is that's the morning that they found out that the Marine Corps rescued Scott O'Grady when he was shot down in Bosnia. He had been on the run.
Oh, yeah. Eating dirt and crawling around. Yeah, absolutely. Right, at the Kosovo. Right.
Exactly. And the president was so excited. And the photographer was there. She was taking pictures, and she gave me that one. But as he was walking, towards me, I popped the door open for him, and I said, "Good morning, sir. Congratulations." And he was going on and on about how much the Marine Corps, what a great job they did. And it was really a cool moment. And it was I hung onto that picture because it was a positive moment in my experience, you know?
And you also said that there was a lot of stuff you got rid of, other evidence. It wasn't just the blue dress with Monica. What was some of the other physical evidence or things that you saw or could have?
So just to be clear to your listeners, I didn't really have anything to do with the blue dress. That was
right,
Monica,
right,
Linda
right.
Tripp, and right. But one time the Navy steward, these are gentlemen from the U.S. Navy who support the president while he's in the Oval Office. They have a mess, which is a Navy word for a kitchen underneath the Oval Office floor, on the ground floor of the West Wing. So they take care of the president. They feed him lunch. They get him water, you know. So Nell was cleaning up after this particular steward was cleaning up after the president one day, and he experienced something he experienced before where he found these tissues in one case and then another case towels that had lipstick on them, and then in another case, another time, had, you know, bodily fluids.
Semen, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if we could say
that. Oh, yeah, please, we say it's a beverage around here.
Yeah. Wow.
He goes, wow.
So thanks for breaking
welcome,
it down.
Welcome to the show.
Wow. Now we can get into
if
some things.
If you'd have said that when I first walked in, I probably wouldn't have gotten emotional. So, but,
He just goes, wow.
So Nell was, you know, he's like, "Oh, Bern, I'm so tired of doing this. It's kind of humiliating." And I said, "I understand, Nell." And I said, "But what are you going to do with him?" He goes, "Well, you know, if I put him in the wash, the guys who do the laundry, they know where it comes from. They'll figure it out." And so my thing was, you know, there was enough rumors running around about the president. And at the time, I had no idea there was an investigation going on. So to me, they were just towels. So I had him throw the towels into a plastic bag that I got out of the trash can, the bottom of the trash can, and I destroyed them. I got rid of them.
That's very careless by him, by the way, by the president. It's like, I mean, you think paper towels and flushing. Yeah. I mean,
I would have, so doesn't that show you? But doesn't that kind of tell you the arrogance of?
That's what I would have said.
This.
Yes,
yeah, I'm just so used to doing this, I could do whatever I want and get away with it.
Someone pick up my jizz rag.
That's about right.
Yeah. I've got to go talk to the ambassador from Afghanistan.
I would have put him in the freezer
just in case.
Yeah, you know,
I would have put him
in the freezer.
You think those pens are valuable that he signed something?
Right? Are you kidding me? This is going to ruin me to do any other radio.
I would put him in the freezer. You said that he had three mistresses at once.
Well,
that came out in the book.
There was three that I know of, yeah.
That you know of, so there might be even more.
Sure. One of the things that agents used to say to me when I was first trying to get Monica Lewinsky removed, and I was complaining about her frequenting around the Oval Office.
What did she do wrong, if I can interrupt you? Like, when you said get her removed, was she doing something inappropriate, or just kind of know what was going on and get annoyed at it? Or?
No, so in the beginning, she was an intern, which means they don't have a hard pass. They have a temporary pass, an intern pass. And they're just, let's say, she was supposed to, her boss worked over in the old executive office building, and let's say you were somebody pretty high up in the government. An intern would be somebody you'd say, you know, I need copies of this, or could you go down and find out what, you know, is going on here? And with Monica, she kept coming over and overstaying. Like, the Secret Service usually doesn't let temporary pass holders or interns into the West Wing. It's usually for the old EOB. But they made exceptions. It was one of these things where the Clinton administration said, you know, you guys are too rigid. We want you to be more user-friendly. And so they came up with this thing where they let the interns in, and then again, you know, we tried to help them inadvertently, and they, you know, they changed the program on us.
So in general, interns were able to get that close to the president?
No, they were not.
And then that's what he was saying. He was saying, let's loosey-goosey it up a little more. Right. Why can't the kids come
that
in?
Was Bill's but that's what I'm saying. Idea, yeah. If they got more loosey-goosey, as McKinley said, then were those interns able to be that close to Clinton in general?
Right. So generally, they weren't, but they started asked us to make exceptions, and we did to try to be more user-friendly. And so it became clear to me that she was constantly trying to put herself in the president's path. And to the point where, and it was funny because I actually questioned one of my coworkers, and they're like, "Oh, you're just being too mean." I'm like, think about this. Every time you're talking to her, and, you know, we wore earpieces when we were inside the West Wing so that people couldn't hear the transmissions. But a lot of times, if nobody was around or you were on break, you'd take the earpiece out because, you know, it bothers your ear. And you would turn the radio on Sure. And she would ask people to, you know, oh, so where's the president? And if she knew he was in the mansion, she would place herself. And it always occurred to me, like, what was she really supposed to be doing? I realized she was an intern, but God, does anybody, I felt like, you know, one time I said, does anybody have a damn job around here, really do anything? So she'd put herself in a path. So when the president came over from the mansion, that she would see him. And
you kind of get that, though. Like, I mean, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, but it's not, you know,
any intern, I guess. Right.
But any intern would try to do that.
Yeah. Right.
In a high profile internship. Yeah,
so, but she kept all the time.
There
all
she
the
is.
Time.
There and, she
and,
is.
Yeah,
there
all
she
the time.
Is.
And other people would,
what was the note by
yeah, he just got I'm not going to ignore
that.
We got to
make believe that that
yeah,
just happened.
Yeah, I was
going to
say thank you.
When I'm done making
thank you.
When I'm done making my point here, okay. I'm going to tell you about the thong story.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. He wrote that thong story.
Oh,
thank
you, sir.
Cisco.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
No. Thumbs up to you, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm not a big fan of thongs.
Yeah.
They hurt.
Yeah. Have it on backwards.
You got to go free.
It clinches his left nut too much.
Yeah, you got to go commando. So,
God damn it, Paul.
Paul, please, I apologize for our alcoholic.
<That's okay.
laughs> Just stumbling around.
What?
So she would constantly put herself in his path.
Okay,
and it became obvious that there was other things going on with her demeanor. So the other officers were telling me the same thing. And so eventually it got to the point where I went to the deputy chief of staff who I had a rapport with. Her name was Evelyn Lieberman. And she was actually the first female deputy chief of staff in the history of the country. And she was a great person. She was very tough. She was one of those people. She got stuff done, you know. So I went in and I asked her assistant. I said, you know, I need a minute with Evelyn. I don't really want to have to tell you. She was like, Gary, no problem. You know, come back in 5 minutes. You can have all the time you want. So I did. And I walked in and knocked on the door and walked in and she said, well, how can I help you, Mr. Byrne? You know, and I said, Evelyn, I'm going to ask you to do something, but you can't really ask me any details. And I'm really kind of overstepping my bounds. And if you want to file a grievance against me with the Secret Service, maybe you should. But I'm going to ask you to do you know the intern, Monica Lewinsky? She said, yeah. And I said, I want you to remove her if you can. She's just an intern. Can you keep her, have her stay over in the old EOB? I can't tell you, but really why, but, and the reason I couldn't, because it involved the president. And I know that sounds silly for me to say that now because I'm kind of spilling the beans, but that's the mentality. So I told her, you know, I can't really give you any details, but it would behoove the president's well-being. And I think the administration's if you removed her.
Can I ask you too about
sure.
that? Like if the president, you knew she wasn't a physical threat
I didn't know that, but okay.
Assuming she wasn't, was it you? Like, you knew what he was doing. Like, all right, here's this, you know, whatever. Are you kind of...
I was still trying to defend him, though. Like, I still hadn't bought in completely.
Looking out for his best interest.
I was trying to.
Were you in a way, though, and again, it's just a question.
Sure.
Seeing something you just didn't like and going, that's not appropriate, and kind of making a moral judgment. Like, hey, look, it's the president, and he's doing something on the side that he shouldn't be doing. Whereas maybe, you could have let it go and not...
Right, I get what you're
not
saying.
Not tattled.
Right, I get what you're saying. Right. Yeah, I get what you're saying. Totally late now.
I like you rolled his eyes.
Not been a rat.
No, but in that moment,
no,
you know?
Something called the God Code.
Yes.
Like if the president knew, he'd probably be like, why did you say something?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Right. Why, are you frustrated?
Yeah.
So, I get what you're saying. But it's closer to this description is... it wasn't, I didn't assume that was what was going on. What I assumed was it was somebody who was an intern and had no business being over there, and she was trying to get herself a better job, and she was getting in the way. There were complaints from other senior staff people about all the interns. So I was just basically doing my job. Now later on, I saw something that convinced me that the rumors were true, and that's, that.
What did you see?
So basically, one particular day, it was a Saturday, and the president was in the Oval Office by himself. His staff wasn't there yet. And all of a sudden, I see Monica Lewinsky coming down the hallway, and she's got this – I don't know if they still do it now because we're in the, you know, the huge age of electronics, but they every night the a group of people would take all the front pages, like the important stuff, off newspapers, and they would copy them and make this, you know, about an inch thick of
– compilation thing.
Right, exactly. Right,
okay.
What's going on in Chicago,
sure.
Miami, you know, wherever. And she has that. She goes, oh, I was directed to give this to the president. I'm like, he's got three copies. what are you doing in here?
He did.
So, she shows up to the, right. for the green room with, right. I brought water.
Right.
No,
right.
there's fucking 40 cases right. of water here. Right. Sorry.
Yeah, it's like showing up at a bar trying to sell beer.
Yeah, I mean, okay, on. All right.
So,
that's true.
So,
but then again, the owner of the bar ordered the beer.
Sure.
Right. Yeah.
Right. No, right. right. Hey, yeah. All I know is the boss said we needed more beer.
Yeah, that's right. And in hindsight, you know, clearly I was yeah. naive.
You were C-blocking the president.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's right. I was not his wingman, unfortunately. So,
I was not his wingman.
So
that should have been the title of the book.
Yeah. I'd rather see Hillary walk in than him.
Does he not know the description of wingman? I believe it clearly is outlined in his job description what the term wingman means.
So they, so you know, I'm like, Monica, you got no business being here. Get, you know, get out. And she left. And a couple minutes later, the Oval Office door opens up. The president says, hey, have you – my impression's terrible. Hey, have you seen an intern trying to deliver something to me? And I'm sure my mouth opened wide up, and I was like, oh, shit. And I'm like – and I actually said, well, no, but if I do, I'll let you know, you know, something along those lines. And he goes, okay, let me know if she shows up. And I'm like, oh, okay. So he closes the door, and I look at the agent, and he goes, I've been telling you. You don't know what goes on the road, you know – it's clear what's going, you know, and I said, yeah, you're right. And then all of a sudden I thought, well, how does he know that she showed up?
Oh, wow. Right.
So she had to have called
yes,
him.
Right. Oh, no, right.
And you just can't pick up the phone
and call the president. And get a hold of the you know what leader of the free
right.
world. Right.
Right. Whether you're in the White House or not. So
we thought our hotline was a secret number.
Right. Right. So clearly she had his private line.
Wow.
And that's how she got a hold of him. And after that, you know, I don't want to say the analogy is probably wrong. I don't want to say the gloves are off, but you know, after that, like it is what it is, and do your job. I just did my job. Right.
Can you ask why, or say why you didn't? Because when he asked you, did anyone come? You did lie to him by saying no one came.
Well, yeah, I did, and
you were panicking.
I was like, holy crap, maybe this is really something important. You know, I saw what she had, and this is, you have to keep it in context. That could have been my 25th run in with her. That okay. may be low,
sure.
could be high. You know, I didn't keep a checklist, but, so that was the, you know, that experience with them.
What was the first thing you saw in the wild? Cause you had the Bushes too, and you said yeah. that, you know, the Barbara and George, they were much, you know, again, a more polite couple, an older couple.
Yeah, it was interesting.
What was the first thing you saw when the Clintons were there that you were like, oh boy?
So, the first weekend they're, the weekend of their inauguration.
Week one, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm standing outside my post, and I see this gentleman walk in, and he's kind of heavy set, and he had a friend with him that was skinny, and, you know, and they walked in, and they looked like they were kind of aggravated. So at this time in the evening, generally, it depends on the last administration, the Bush administration, they were allowed to do tours at this time, but the Clintons hadn't set up what they wanted us to allow. Mm-hmm. So anyway, we were kind of allowing it. So this guy comes in, and he has a temporary hard pass, and the guy with him had a visitor's pass. And the guy walks up to me, and he has this necklace around his neck that I now know is called a gay freedom necklace. You know, and I didn't know what it was at the time, but it was beautiful. It was like a braided steel chain, and then around it were these metal rings that were colored. And, you know, I think it's seven different colors.
All right.
Or five. So he walks up to me, puts his thumb underneath it, and he walks right to my face, and, you know, like my comfort zone. And and he goes, this is my gay freedom necklace. And I'm like, oh, okay, good for you. And you know,
like that's a pass.
Right, right. And you know, I got the, you know, the impression that he felt that because I was law enforcement, I was homophobic or something. You know, right. That's not my business. I don't care what anybody does, and, you know. So anyway.
Well, I wouldn't phrase that considering the book.
Yeah, well, yeah. Right. So I'm going to have to change that. Right. If you don't get me subpoenaed, I don't care.
Yeah. See, yeah. That's yeah. the line in the sand. Yeah. Yeah. See, once I got to go to court, fuck you.
Yeah. So, yeah, all bets are off. So, yeah, good point.
Good point.
Yeah. So, but I mean, as far as somebody's choices.
Boy, you're a nosy body.
Yeah. As far as somebody's choices, of who they like, love.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whoever somebody loves, that's who they love. Okay. That's not my business, right? So,
but he was challenging you for no reason.
Right,
thinking
right.
That you
and it was comical. So they're looking in there, and he goes to, I don't know if he tried to like take a step in there. I said, no, we don't go in the Oval Office. That's where the rope's up. He goes, well, you know, we're here now, and we're going to have different rules. We're in charge. And I'm like, yeah, it doesn't work like that. So they said something. They start to walk down the hallway, and as they're walking down the hallway, I see the skinny guy doing, you know, something like this, and I'm like,
his hands going out in different directions.
Yeah, I'm like, what the? Yes, thank you. We're on radio.
Exactly.
Yeah. No. So he's actually putting stuff on the furniture and sticking stuff on the walls, and I'm like, you know, I started to like almost seize. I'm like, oh my god, you know,
like Post-its.
Yes, like little stickers.
Really?
Yeah,
sure.
They were gay freedom stickers, and so I run down the hallway and I'm like, stop. And the guy turns around. I said, you can't do that. This is the White House. It's a working museum. Christ, you know, everything in here is important. And
right. Priceless.
History. And
no
yeah.
Shit.
Sure. Yeah. And he's like, well, we're in charge now. And, you know, as he's talking, I keyed my radio and I gave my call sign. And I said, you know, I need assistance. And a couple of people responded. And I described what was going on. And the sergeant came up and they grabbed, a sergeant and officer grabbed both of them. They walked them out to the front gate. And, I did see the one guy later on, but eventually he disappeared. The guest was never allowed back in. And of course, then the White House, the people of the White House that clean it up and take care of it, maintain it. That part of the West Wing is taken care of the GSA by the GSA administration. Yeah. And they had to come in and remove the stickers, and they were more upset about it than I was. They were like, oh my God, what's going on here? Why would anybody think it's okay to stick stickers on, you know, a 150-year-old pinbroke counter or, you know, table?
Did you ever walk in on Bill and Monica, or Bill, like I know, the President and Monica?
Right.
Was there ever a moment where that happened?
Where I walked in on them? No. But I did, like I described to you, I let her in. And then,
and then you knew about the aftermath.
Right.
Right.
Right. Right. So, I mentioned the thong story earlier. Did you want to hear that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So.
Not if it's racy.
Yeah. Well, I think we kind of crossed that threshold.
Not in here ever.
Yeah. So, so one day I'm standing at my post, the president's in the Oval Office, or the president's over in the West Wing, you know, and he was in the Oval Office, and then he had moved to George Stephanopoulos' office right next door. And I could hear him in there, and I actually walked, you know, I think I turned to the agent and, you know, motioned that he had moved into the office next door. So, I moved down a little bit closer to Stephanopoulos' door, and he was in there talking to George, and then all of a sudden Monica comes from, actually like from the east side, moving west, you know. And she comes down the hallway, and you know, she had a pass. I don't remember which one at the time, but, you know, she hears the president's voice, you know, and you could just see her whole demeanor change. And she stops in front of the doorway, and the president sees her. And at this point, like, I'm not sure the time frame. I don't know where their relationship is. Like I said, I didn't walk around, you know, keeping notes at the time. And so anyway, you know, he says hi, she says hi, and they're talking and everything. I do remember this, now that I'm telling the story again. As she's talking to him, she actually looks back at me, because by this time we've had a lot of run-ins. And she actually looks back at me, and I take a couple steps closer, and, you know, and she says something to him, and then she kind of started walking down the hallway. And as she's walking away, she turns around to make sure that he's watching her, and then she flips up her dress, and underneath her dress, she had this blue thong on. I was like, oh crap, that's weird. And I turned back to the agent, and I said, did you see that? He goes, I feel like I'm working in a nightclub. And I'm like, oh, yeah,
wow.
Whatever. You know, now I will tell you, I never saw that during the Bush administration. So,
sure.
So you know,
there wasn't any thong flashing for HW.
No, there was not.
We obviously all know about Monica Lewinsky. What about some of the other women?
So the one other thing that I talk about in my book, Crisis of Character, was,
he always gets a title in, by
he's
the
smart.
Way.
Yeah.
That's
and
good plugging.
And it's very,
that's good plugging, my friend.
And it's very, very informative what I've read so far.
So before, actually, let me tell you something real quick about the title. Originally, because it was more about my life, I was more focused on my life, other parts of my life. It was called Fence Jumpers to Hijackers. You know, Fence Jumpers to the White House and Hijackers when I became an Air Marshal.
Right.
And the publisher said, oh, that's a great title, but we're not going to use it. So,
okay.
Yeah. So this was part of a title of one of the chapters, and we...
Right.
Actually, yeah. Grant kind of came up with it.
All right.
So, anyway.
This is a perfect title.
Thank you so much.
Don't
elect
long.
That bitch would have been the better one.
Yeah, right. Fuck that cunt. Wouldn't have worked out. Would not have worked out.
I'm not even sure how to react to it.
Just do it.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh,
did I say that out loud? I'm sorry. I apologize.
Wow. So satellite is their deal.
Satellite.
Yeah. Yes. Satellite is the deal.
Yeah.
I know why Howard Stern did this.
Yeah, absolutely. You can say whatever you want.
So, I'm sorry. Where was I? I was
Other women. Maybe something that's not even in the book. Maybe a little something you remembered.
Actually, if it's not in the book, then for other reasons, I decided never to write about it or talk about it.
That's the good stuff.
You're going to make him cry again.
That's the good stuff.
No, it's not even so much that. It's that, you know, as I was writing the book, like I said earlier, clearly I've crossed the line somewhere, but for the lack of a better description, there's probably 50% of the material that is not in there, and I'll never talk about it because some of it reveals processes of the Secret Service, and I realize they can't stand me now, but it is what it is. I still have some loyalty to what it was I did, and I believe in their mission, but there's some things I won't talk about, but this particular thing, it is in the book, and it's I'm walking back from the east side. It's during the Christmas holiday, and they just had some kind of function earlier in the day, so all the leftover food is in the east wing break room.
Right.
So I make a beeline over to the leftover food from the White House chef, and after I get my fill, I'm walking back from the east side to the west side on the ground floor, and I pass this area where there's a friend of mine on post, and there's a couple agents standing around because the president's obviously nearby, and we're talking and everything, and a Navy steward walks up, a different Navy steward, and he's got a clean shirt for the president. You see this all the time. He changes his shirt once a day sometimes. And, you know, so anyway, he says that he knows the president's in the map room, I guess. And he starts heading towards the map room, and I'm talking to my friend and this other agent, and the steward opens the door. And when we look in, now he's looking at us like you're looking at me.
Right.
And we're looking into the room, and there's the president with Eleanor Mondale, like two high school seniors, and, you know, making out. You know, they're standing up in front of a table and they're making out. And, you know, I was like, holy crap, man.
Full on tongue kissing, grab ass, and making out.
Yeah. It just never stops.
Yeah.
And, so the steward finally looks into the room and sees what we see because he sees our reaction, and he's like all flustered, and he closes the door and he takes off with the shirt. And I look at the agent and the officer, and I'm like, did you guys see that? And they're like, yep. And, you know, and I asked, like, that's unbelievable. And again, one of the agents mentions, you just don't have any idea what goes on the road.
On the road. I love how you keep saying on the road.
Yeah, that was,
let me ask you this. So, it has been said over the years that Bill just had an understanding with Hillary. She knew this shit was going on.
Sure, I could believe that. Yeah,
and you do, and you.
I mean, I'm not 100% convinced, but I don't disagree with you. You know, I mean, I do believe she got, like, I do have this theory, like when it was clear that he had to admit that he was having this affair with the intern, with Mr. Lewinsky, that she found out. And this was actually in newspapers too, but she found out because his attorney went over, the president's attorney went over and told the first lady. And actually, if you went and researched it, the timeline, and you saw pictures of them getting off the helicopter the first time after she found out, the change in her demeanor, and you certainly understand why. But the change in her demeanor was like, he grabbed her hand as they walked off the helicopter, and the look on her face was, you know, if nobody was watching,
I'd punch you in the face.
It'd be on.
Right.
I mean, that's based on my experiences with him and what I saw. But like I said, I think the lawyer actually had to tell him. But my take on it is, she wasn't so much upset about the infidelity. She was worried about the damage to the Clinton name, the Clinton brand.
Right.
You know, because
she was probably used to the infidelity. I mean, that's.
I mean, based on what if you look at what we were told from the people we knew in Arkansas and even some of the staff members sometimes, you know, they came up with them, you know, yeah, that was what happened, you know, so.
They're telling us you have to wrap up. Travis is saying that you go to the press, but, Gary, the book is called Crisis of Character. And I wish I had read all of it. I'd flip through it. I would go back to the beginning, and it's very good. I mean,
thank you so much.
Even the stuff that's non this. Yes. This stuff about the White House, people lining up trying to bring a gun and a sock in. There's a whole bunch of stuff that you'd never think these guys have to deal with, but it's really fascinating.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah, right on, man.
Yeah, and thank you for letting me say bad words on the video.
Hey, thank you. I said most of them.
All right, yes. Gary Byrne, everyone. Crisis of Character, available now.
Take a break.
Thank you. Yeah, well, let's take a quick break.
I didn't say that on
him. Just what if we get a picture, too?
Yeah, we kind of mind.
No, we're not taking any photographs.
I don't take pictures of rats.
Hope he's part Cherokee.
It's a rat.
It's a snitch. I mean, Carmelo wouldn't do this picture. He'll be snitching.
Yeah. I believe I'm still broadcasting. I'm not taking a picture of that. That nosy body.
He could snap all of our necks with a fucking... I will snap his fingers and kill us. You know he could.
Yeah, we'll be back. Yeah, we're back. I could check something off my bucket list. Taking a leak next to Samuel Jackson.
That was
on my bucket list, and it just went down.
Young Jim Norton told me that. I'm totally jealous.
Were
there snakes in a plane?
I did want to take a peek. I'm not going to lie to you.
He looks so much like Samuel Jackson because it was, but I said to E-Rock outside, that guy looks like Sam Jackson. I think he might work here.
Right.
Because he looks so... I just wasn't expecting to be urinating next to Gator.
I was next to him. You were almost next to him.
No, I purposely gave us his... I gave him his celebrity space.
You did the homophobic urinal spacing.
Yeah, Jimmy was already in there. I'm walking to take my leak, and I see him going to the bathroom. I'm like, holy shit, be cool. And then then there was only one urinal left, and it was in between two huge stars, Jim Norton and Samuel Jackson.
That's right. I wouldn't have been able to do it.
I got the sweet spot.
I was gonna say I wouldn't have gone in there. I would have been.
You wouldn't have went.
I would have been cock shy.
I just made believe I didn't know it was him.
I like it.
That backfires too because it's so obvious you're trying to make believe
to look down right.
But that was pretty cool.
No kidding. No, he just told me. He's like, you're not going
to. And then I'm looking at Jimmy, and I'm like, I'm trying to figure out how Jimmy could just lift his camera and do one of those, like, sort of selfies. We've done them over the years with Ricky Gervais and others in the bathroom.
I got one with him already, so I didn't care about getting a photo.
What about me?
You should ask him.
The Leno conversation. Scared. Do you remember when Leno was here a couple of weeks ago, and we were all in, all of us were in there for a minute. It was the same kind of thing. It was very surreal to have the show going on in the bathroom when no one could listen.
Oh, we've done that many a time. That's
good fun, though.
Good fun. Did you see Jay Leno's crash?
No, my God. Yes, I did. Yes.
We didn't talk about that yesterday.
Oh, it's brutal.
You haven't seen
Jim.
It yet?
No, it's fucking bad.
Oh, it's been out a couple days now.
Yeah. I've heard about it.
Well, first of all, he's got a guy, the driver was in his 80s, I think.
Yep.
Oh, no.
I think he was 82, and he
just went to Staten Island and jumped. It's the same guy.
You haven't seen this. He rolled.
No, this is a
That's
fucking
the long version.
Horrible.
Here you go.
Well, he's driving a...
I forgot what he wanted to do. It was on his bucket list to, ride on two wheels and a...
He's trying to get him to do the Joy Chitwood thing, where you go up on two wheels and ride around when the car's halfway up. No, why are you laughing, Paul?
Yeah, what are you laughing at?
Joy Chitwood? Are you laughing at the Joy Chitwood? You're too young to know the Joy Chitwood.
I think he's still laughing at Fucker and the Cunt.
Fuck that cunt.
Fuck that cunt. Whatever.
Fuck that cunt is what the name of the book should have been.
Yeah, that's wonderful, Vic.
But he couldn't. I know. I bring a lot to the show.
It's garbage. I'm
sure y'all are happy you invited me around.
Here you go. I can't believe it. Yeah, this is pretty crazy, man. Oh, my God. Wow.
Yeah. No, it's brutal.
Yeah.
Damn it. You all right?
Oh boy, it's Conan. Okay. Conan's driving.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, got the guy running out with the extinguisher. Get a hold of yourself.
Oh, but Jay's like, what the fuck? But listen to this. This is great.
What's your name?
Bob Riggle.
Howdy, Bob.
80.
What track are we at, Bob?
You're at Irwindale.
And he can't hurt you right now.
No.
My name is Bob Riggle, and I'm 80, and I'm at Irwindale.
No, it's not.
Always the comic. Always the comedian. That's fucking
awesome. That's pretty crazy. You see them. I mean, they have a camera inside the vehicle, obviously, and you see Jay trying to figure out how to get out of this. How do I keep myself safe? What?
I don't have my mic, but he's good with positioning his arm so it didn't go out the window.
Yes.
He was smart enough to make sure
he goes into crash position,
Right. Man, but that rolled. I wonder how many times it rolled over.
Looks like two or three. Well, we'd have to count it if you want, but it looks like at least two.
Then some people were trying to say, you got one out.
You got
one out.
Well, there's one, two.
But then they go to the other angle.
Yeah,
so
right.
Then,
you don't know.
You don't know if they're making a little TV magic, but it's still impressive.
It's at least one. It looks like two or three.
It seems like it's at least two or three, yeah. So, but Jay's just fine.
Where's Roland, by the way?
Sleeping.
Why?
Sleeping.
I have a question for him.
Sleeping.
Can you bring him in?
He's asleep.
You have a question for Roland?
I do.
He's asleep.
Oh, boy.
Sticking with my same joke. I'm just going to say he's asleep. And why is Travis waving a giant Lysol can in the window?
Oh.
Have you been shitting in the room again?
No, but he just has it because he pretends it's a fist and he sits on it.
That's what he calls break time.
Yeah, he started with a little off can and that doesn't do the trick anymore.
He's graduated.
Certainly has.
Into WD-40.
That's right.
He's keeping the Lysol away from us, too, which isn't nice.
Yeah, no, it's rude.
I think they're taking the Lysol out of here on purpose.
All right, here comes Roland.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Comes Roland.
Right.
What's up, Rob?
I had a question. Now, apparently I missed it, but what happened? There was some kind of an altercation, which I didn't see, in the studio between Roland and Paul.
Whoa, what happened? What?
Nothing.
That's not a satisfactory
long soul buildup.
Wait, what happened?
No, I don't know.
No, just the publicist walking around and asked Paul to tell him to sit down, and Paul wouldn't. I said, can you just tell him? He said no, which is fine.
I didn't say no.
Yeah, he said it's not my job, so.
Yeah, your job's to deal with the publicist.
I know,
aren't they supposed to be back in the producer's studio watching the interview and not being a disruption in the back?
Not technically, though. Sometimes if they're a fan of the show, the guys do let them.
You're the gatekeeper. You open the door and let them walk right in.
No, I set them down because they're fans of the show.
Yeah, they could watch from back. What makes them different than everybody else that comes through, like the publicist who's sitting in the back?
Why are you so passive aggressive being a dick right now?
I'm just saying that.
I could tell you apart, but I just have no energy right now.
Wait, what's going on?
Same
I'm still
that,
confused,
but...
though.
Wait, that's what I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah.
This is called workplace grievance.
So we all help each other out. If you're in the studio, you can sit down.
Oh, yeah,
down.
We all do.
Wow, look at Paul.
Stop breathing, Paul.
Well, you have a hard job just putting all the cameras in the stand, too. So.
You see that I edit all night, because when you live with us before you were kicked out, but instead, for the first hour of the show, your feet are propped up on my chair and snoring pretty loud.
I lovers quarrel.
That has nothing to do with it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Wait, he snores?
Yes.
But his job's done by then, right?
Yes.
Show's all booked and ready to go, and Roland takes a little time for himself.
A little snoreroos.
What's wrong with that?
Yes.
Wait, so...
Roland got kicked out?
You're talking about the guy that came over with the note.
Yeah.
Okay, guy was not supposed to be in here, according to...
No, he was a co-author.
No, he was a big fan of the publicists, right there. They're big fans of Jimmy's. They saw him on tour. They'll just sit there and see Jimmy in action.
Yeah, I talked to her. She was an Amy fan. So she's I love you, Amy.
And the other guy was the co-writer. So what?
So I just asked him not to get up, and that was it.
And then they sat down, and I was like, oh, okay. And then they got up moving around, and you start panicking again.
No, can you ask him to sit down, please?
And what am I supposed to do when he sat over here?
Fine.
Wait, so when the guy gave up to give Gary Byrne a note, that was like what?
No, I just had to say, please just don't get up. Then I came in and just told the guy.
Yeah, was what I'm saying. I thought I heard something. Yeah. I didn't know, but I didn't know there was a whole thing with you guys.
Yeah.
They were moving around a lot.
If you could tell them, please.
Yeah. They were. I'm with Travis. They were, yeah.
Yeah, that's all I asked. Well, I don't
care if they're moving around a lot. I figured
just for the video,
it's bad.
Yeah,
we're all good.
That's all I asked.
Oh,
yeah.
All right. But
because it looks bad. If the guy's getting to something important,
right,
and all of a sudden there's somebody in the back, you know.
Yeah, that's all I asked.
Wow.
So you didn't want them moving around, and then you told Paul to take care of the situation?
No, I just said, Paul, can you just tell him to sit down?
He sent me a text, and they were sitting down.
No, but
and then they got up and started moving again.
Because Travis said they're getting up.
If you want to worry about people in the background of videos, you're caught in the background sleeping majority of the time in the background of videos.
Look
at any of the comments on any of the videos.
Well, my job is to book. My job is not to stay awake half the time. My job is to book. I'm done.
So you're doing a great job. You're doing a great job at that, Ben.
I am. You have the one for me. The ministers, you and I have the videos.
Face.
Yeah, my video went viral. No, because I brought Ricky Gervais in. That's why it went viral, not because you're editing.
Oh, wow.
Boom, I got your boyfriend.
Damn.
I'm saying.
So you're saying when your job is done, you could take a little time for yourself and sleep.
Any moment, right.
No.
You just said that.
I'm on your side.
Yes. You said the book, and then boom, here they're coming in. There you go. And then when they're ready, I go out, talk to the publicist, talk to them, and I'm up, reading, and do my job.
So there's been a long time coming between you two?
You guys
were roommates for a while?
I don't have a problem with Roland.
Well, you brought up the fact that he got kicked out.
Was happy with it. Fine, I got kicked out.
And I was in his room 30 seconds after he left, because it's the better room.
Oh, you were happy?
Wow.
A little bit.
Wait, what?
Why'd you get kicked out? What happened? The guy? What made you? Did he not pay his bills?
Oh, Larry! Go get Larry! It's Larry's house. Oh, Larry!
What am I missing?
I'm Larry. Happy now. I live by myself.
Roland, and Paul were all living together, and it seemed like they were a very happy team.
No, Paul and Larry, they
were making videos
good,
and going out to eat together.
We had a trio. It just didn't work out.
And then Larry kicked Roland out.
Paul?
Fucking Larry.
Paul, what do you know about this?
I think Larry is the one with the boot.
Yeah, I'm fine with it. I'm very happy right now. I got my own place.
Do you talk to Larry?
Yeah. We went to the beach last week together.
Yes, we did.
I have no ill will against anybody.
You went to the beach with Larry? What an awful trip that must have been.
Horrendous.
Yeah, that's the thing, though. I have no problems with anybody.
Larry went to the beach.
What beach did you go to?
Brighton. Wasn't it Brighton?
Brighton, Manhattan Beach.
All right, Larry. Yeah. Larry, it all came out today. Paul's taking cheap shots about Roland being kicked out of your house.
Right. It's all on you, Larry.
So what happened,
Larry?
Larry,
I have to lift the mic.
Yeah.
My little
what happened?
About what?
There you are, doll.
Well, obviously, you opened your home to Paul and Roland.
And your backside.
What happened, though? What did I miss? What happened?
Well,
why are they fighting?
Well, because Paul and Roland are fighting about something else, but then Paul decided to throw in the fact that he got kicked out of the house.
Wow.
And now that's your house, so I want to know what happened.
I already told you what happened. I told Jimmy.
You didn't tell me.
No, but now it's
thrown out.
I don't know.
Yeah, now it's for the air, I guess.
I said he moved out.
Yes, he moved out. Exactly. But
yeah,
Paul just
didn't say that. We both had mutual agreement, though. Like, I'm just living by myself.
Yes.
I'm a messy creature at times.
Big time.
Yeah, so.
A what?
Oh, it had something to do with him being messy?
Yeah. Messy. You used to say I'm a messy creature?
Well, yeah.
Oh, but talk fast.
The thing is,
yeah, I didn't know what he said. I thought he said Leon.
I know. I'm like, what's a messiature? Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right. No, I was
all right, hold on. So, defend Roland a little bit, but then on the other side, Larry's awfully over the top neat.
Fastidious. Yeah.
No, I'm not.
Paul?
Look at that shitty shirt he's wearing.
He is very, very ego, but I'm used to a different way because I live by myself. I pay my rent on time and everything.
Yeah.
Always.
He always paid early. He would give it to me early.
That's cool. So he must have been a real problem to get rid of that because that's a good tenant right there.
Yeah, you don't want somebody paying early.
You got a guy paying early and you still said, fuck that, you can't live here. That means something was going on.
Paul, comment?
Yeah, Paul.
I'm fine.
Okay, cool.
Why did Roland get kicked out? You had the balls to bring this up. Why did my pal Roland get kicked out?
Larry was
house?
A little disgruntled by his mess that was left behind.
Was he peeing
Only
in the
me?
Sink?
Only
oh.
me.
Oh,
we had to
go.
Clean up some messes.
Oh no! It wasn't a bunch of like towels with lipstick. Not a whole Secret Service thing, is it?
Perhaps
that was in Austin.
Maybe a donut box filled with shit. Do you ever have to pick that up? Maybe?
No, we all got the stomach virus.
All right.
What kind of mess did you have to clean up?
I'm a messy creature.
Puke from where?
Oh, I got
stomach virus.
Yeah.
Oh no! Where'd you puke?
Everywhere.
All over.
Yeah.
Why not just in the toilet?
Yeah,
I did that too.
Okay.
And so I woke up, I was choking, and because I had the real bad stomach, I just vomited in my sleep. It just came out.
Oh, no.
You vomited in your sleep.
Because it was like, I got so sick. Like, when I opened my eyes, like, blah.
All right. So you just woke up puking.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Paul and Larry had to clean up some of that puke?
They were great. But then I did buy them something, like a thank you gift for cleaning it up.
Where'd you buy them?
I bought, Paul, his suitcase he needed, and then bought them lunch and breakfast.
Luggage. So luggage and a meal. Breakfast.
That's cool. They promptly hand it to you. Pack your shit.
That's soon after.
If you get sick, you get sick.
Yeah, but Larry and I came to mutual agreement. Hey, this is his house. He likes it this way.
I would never
conform into that. So we both go, you know what?
What was the problem with Larry, though? That
I
you
felt bad doing it, but I just couldn't
I just,
do
I,
it anymore.
How did you say it to Roland? What phrasing?
You know, he just said, look, you know, we hid the headway.
Through
it's
tears.
It's just not working out. Yeah, I have no problem with Larry.
But what did Larry need from you that you weren't doing?
Probably picking up after myself. I do. I mean, I get tired, and I just call. Like, I'm with publicists and emails all day long and all night long. It doesn't stop.
Right.
So then the last thing I do is clean up because I'm just tired. I just email and text all day, and I just shut down. And then when I shut down, I totally shut down. I don't do nothing. Just recharge. I leave mess.
I leave mess.
Yes.
I leave mess.
Hey, just actually got a clean book. Why tissues in there? Any mess? Hey,
there's vomit on the floor. I was emailing.
And on the walls.
And texting. Yeah. I leave mess.
Hey, how come there's vomit in the ceiling fan? I've been emailing all day.
And then you guys better
you clean it up. I'm going to go to the luggage store.
Yes, take me to the luggage store.
I leave mess.
Do you like Toomey? What the fuck's going on?
Yeah, well, from me. Go ahead. I'm being cute.
Ah, fuck yeah.
Rumor has it there were some roaches that started appearing.
Roaches?
Or bugs or
something. Not the good kind. Yeah, not the good kind.
Oh, mice.
It was a mad there.
Just a mice.
So you're blaming the mouse on Roland?
Well, it was the gerbil, at least.
According to Discovery Channel, if you have bird food, it does attract mice, too.
Yeah, but if you also have granola bars and mice droppings all on the floor...
Oh. That's coincidence.
I've never had a mouse in a bedroom upstairs.
Until
wait, you had Orlando. You got mice in your... How many mice?
If you have one...
Paul saw one.
No, Jimmy taught me this years ago, and he was 100% right in the end. If there's one, there's hundreds.
Oh, yeah, there's 20.
I meant tranny stories.
And I had to call an exterminator.
You had to call the exterminator.
And I put poison down, and...
And I said, I'll pay for it. I like more than one to pay for anything.
Yeah, that's beside... I don't see that side. I didn't need, like, you know... Yeah, I didn't need him to pay for it. I just wanted him to clean up his act.
You want him to fuck out.
That was soon after, yes.
But soon after? But the mouse was the final straw?
I think so.
Wait, there was granola crumbs on the floor where in the bedroom?
Yeah.
What did Roland's room look like?
It wasn't too messy because just a bed and TV.
Why is Paul laughing?
holding in a laugh.
Paul, comment.
Describe Roland's room.
Mm.
Good.
There's some rappers on the floor and some clues.
Oh, which ones? I like the
Reese's.
Run DMC.
T.I. Young Jeezy. Fetty Wap.
There were just some rappers on the floor. That's no big deal. That sounds like an average room.
It's okay. African Bambaataa was just laying
there. It does,
though.
A couple rappers here and there. Ah, what are you going to do?
I have no rappers on my floor, but again, I'm afraid of bugs. That's what scares me.
My point is I think it was way more than a few rappers, and these boys aren't willing to commit.
What kind of rappers?
Go ahead, Paul.
Granola wrappers, Reese's Pieces.
That was in mine. It was in my pocket for some reason. I mean,
I was holding it for a friend.
It's not my jacket. Greg.
Sorry.
Roland's giving cocaine excuses for fucking Reese's Pieces.
It's not my jacket, Dad. It's not my cigarettes.
I'm really enjoying it.
All right, just a few rappers. Who cares? You kick a guy out for that.
To find a place and
did you clog the toilet a few times?
I'm sure I did.
Did he?
Larry?
No. There's no, it doesn't seem to be.
I had my own bathroom.
So he's okay.
Yeah.
Paul, nothing?
I mean, I've cleaned that bathroom before when everyone was in Austin. I, did a whole cleaning.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so you clean somebody else's shit in your own home?
Well, it's also my house, though, too. I mean, let it go to shit.
I do the same thing. No.
You let it go to shit because you had Roland.
Didn't say that.
Was the bedroom a mess or no when you got there?
Well, when
there's a couple wrappers,
what?
Just a couple wrappers on the grass, not bad.
Yeah,
I have clothes on the floor.
There's more.
I promised Roland I didn't. I didn't want.
But you just mouthed more to Jim Norton. And what was supposed to ignore that?
Exactly. Normally you say that to me over your shoulder.
I'm going to look like the bad guy.
Well, I saw them argue. There was something that happened. We didn't know what. I had no idea what it was about. Yeah. So I'm asking Paul and Roland, and then this kind of morphs into that. This is not what we intended to talk about.
I think this.
It's over.
I'm asking.
Real friendly. There were clothes on the floor. It was messy.
Yeah. It was messy.
Do you have a bird? I thought he said...
I got a parrot. Yeah.
Okay. So was his room messier than the bottom of the bird cage? Was his room messier?
It was even. I mean, I can't clean up that cage. It's a pigsty. It's a lot. I got to get rid of
even?
Her. You want a parrot?
No. Sure. You're a fucking weirdo for having a goddamn bird pet.
You'll kill it.
Sure.
I wouldn't hurt an animal. I would just let it starve slowly.
I'd bite its fucking head off. That's a useless pet.
Did it talk?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It laughs just like them, too.
It says, get the fuck rolling out of our apartment. That's the only thing the bird can say.
That's a fuck, though.
So.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, I'm by myself. So that's fine.
We helped him move back in and stopped for runs at BJ's.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
He'll come into Brooklyn. Yeah, and then we go to BJ's, happen. And then I'll drive him back and walk up his four
give each other what?
Fucking stairs.
Reach around.
So.
What'd you do to the room after Roland left?
I just cleaned it.
Sandblasted.
John and Iowa makes a very good point. He's on the phone, but he says, finds it funny Roland admits to vomiting in the sink, but won't own up to candy wrappers.
Not true.
Yes.
True.
You vomited in the sink?
No, I didn't vomit in the sink.
I saw a lady die.
Oh.
Oh, in the toilet. All right. John thought he was.
That was great. You vomited in the sink. That was the same cadence that LaManna asked Vicky. You sucked his cock. You vomited in the sink? Yeah, fucking vomited in the sink. What do you care?
What do you care? Is that it? Paul. Yeah. So what? How did you clean the room after Roland left to get it ready for Paul, who obviously quickly moved into
Roland's
room?
Oh, he certainly did.
Yeah, he had the bigger room.
He has the bigger room.
Why did you like Roland's room better?
It's painted better. It's put together better.
Oh, no. What's wrong with you? What, can't you just repaint
Well, the other
yours?
One has the back porch, and so Larry's got to take the dog out through the back porch.
I knew that.
Oh, he's gotta
See, you didn't like that I had to walk through
I
the
like
dog.
A back porch, but, you know, I mean, I like a little outdoor space, but that's me.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does. He has a whole...
He didn't mind it, but Larry has to walk through his room
every
day.
Well, I'm too lazy to walk my dog, so I just put him in the backyard so he could shit.
Does the dog try to eat the bird ever?
Should just put him in Roland's room.
Does he? Mm. The dog does try to eat the bird. Let the dog eat the bird.
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
No way.
Let the dog eat the bird.
What kind of dog you got?
A boxer.
Yeah. I'll fucking totally let him eat the bird, especially. No, if it was a Yorkie, I might go back to your side.
I
did leave bread down. The dog ate the bread.
He left.
Oh, no shit. You left food out and the dog ate it.
Yeah.
Really? That's a surprise of
the
year.
Why do you know the dog wonders? So that's why
he left. He would eat and drop lettuce on the floor, and the dog ate it and threw up and everything. Yeah. He's trying to kill my bird and my dog. Yeah.
He ate plastic, too.
It sounds like these boys worked it out. They went to the beach together. They went to the beach together, so you guys worked it out. You're still friends?
Yeah.
Just figured you can't live together.
No.
And
some people, you're better friends than living together. Just like life.
Just like life. But it seems like you got a little issue with Paul.
No, I'm over it. I'm like,
I think it's resolved now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we worked it out in here in Dr. Phil style.
Yeah.
You just very good. Like the interaction. Okay. That makes sense.
Yeah.
That's okay, cool.
All right. Dismissed.
Thank you.
Let Larry go. We're holding him fucking hostage. He's looking at me the whole time like, how long have I got to sit here and answer these goddamn questions?
Brutal.
What did you iron your shirt with? A tire iron?
I got a dry clean.
It's all wrinkled.
It's very wrinkly.
No, it's very wrinkly. Fire that dry cleaner.
God almighty. Jesus. Tim Roth's fucking shirt wasn't as in bad a shape in Reservoir Dogs.
Wow, nice call, Jimmy.
Good shot.
Nice call.
Look how wrinkled it is.
That's what I'm saying. He's a neat freak, really?
Yeah, he is.
And he gets his shirts dry cleaned. What happened now?
No, very clean.
Ooh, Larry took offense to you saying that he was a neat freak.
No, he's very, very clean.
Oh, that's not an insult.
No.
A neat freak.
Yeah.
I don't know. Him and Mars are making knowing eyes at each other.
Mars, what's going on? You really enjoyed that.
Oh, yeah.
Why did you enjoy it so much?
Yeah, there's a lot more to it, but it's not in my place.
Oh, Mars.
But you can't just say that.
You can't just say that.
Give me one example.
Yeah,
give me one little tidbit.
You said on the air, well, there's a lot more.
One little tidbit.
How about what's one more thing? So we don't even show it.
Yeah, one little tidbit.
You're being like the Secret Service guy that said, oh, I know a million things, but I'm not putting that in the book.
Yeah, that's tough to hear.
Just know about the sloppiness, that's all.
The sloppiness is way worse than what was described?
Yes.
Puerto Rican here is clean.
Get the fuck
out of here. It's not in my place. Go back to your parade and yell. And go stab a person.
I was trying to
take that.
It's not in my place.
Look at him. He's stopping. He's totally rolling. He's barking them all down from all corners.
Yeah.
Roland is the Iceland.
Well, what's one example? How can it be messy? Roland admitted to some rappers on the ground and some fucking mouse.
Maybe one little example.
Something,
Mars.
Come on.
One little thing that you heard through the grapevine.
Got nothing, man.
Wow.
Paul?
I don't know.
Wow. Larry? Now Larry's calling.
Now Larry's angry again.
Go ahead, Larry.
Go ahead, Larry.
Just say it.
You know what's wrong.
All right, Larry's coming back. Here we go.
I'm playing with my pee-pee.
There was a turd in the soap dish.
Wait, what?
I had a bottle of lube on the floor. I played with my pee-pee.
I didn't say that.
A bottle of lube? Who cares?
He wasn't alluding to that.
Paul stepped in Roland's piss in the bathroom.
Oh, no.
He stepped all over it.
I wiped it with wipes every time I the Clorox wipes every time I use the bathroom because I was paranoid.
It only puddles.
Wait, you stepped in a puddle of Roland's piss? A
little splatter.
Yeah, you're blessed now.
Holy water.
I marked my territory. Fuck this place.
Mars, is that what you heard?
Yeah.
He doesn't want to talk.
He's still sitting on Mars, something good.
Mars is
sitting on
the mic.
He's making fun of your job.
Paying attention. What did you say?
You fix the mic.
He's basically saying how you fix mics is you just shake it a little bit.
He's saying basically you just move them back and forth
and hope that it starts working again.
He's a good observer.
Yes.
Wow, Mars does not want in. Mars loves.
No kidding, right?
Mars loves jumping in. That's why he's in here. All right.
Where's Don Wickham? We need him. I'm ready to attack.
That was really good.
Down the hall.
Oh. I'm enjoying it.
All right, so Roland's a little sloppy. What are you going to do?
So he said, so there's a little lube. Who cares if you jerk off?
Lube, nothing.
They found your lube?
Yeah, threw it on the floor.
Wait, your lube was on the floor?
Yeah, the bottle.
What kind of lube you use?
Astroglide.
Astroglide's horrible. Turns into rubber cement in 2 minutes. Get Eros.
Ooh.
I really am missing the point of this discussion.
How'd you call your vice?
Yes. Jimmy's annoyed you. He's in the room.
I know.
Oh, I'm joking.
I totally went down the wrong area.
Oh, I love it.
So what's the big deal if you find his lube?
Did you find
his... I'd say it was a problem.
Did he put things in his hiney?
No.
All right. That wouldn't be a problem either.
God, I want to know what Mars knows.
This asshole.
I know.
What does Mars know?
He's sitting on something.
Mars is being a little tight-lipped.
Yeah, Mars, what do you know?
He's not saying. He's not going to do
this. This is unlike Mars.
Mars needs women. Doom, 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 doom. Nothing. He's not coming across. I thought I'd give him a pause. He didn't take it.
No?
I got nothing.
All right.
We've pretty much heard it, right, Mars?
Yep.
It's not that bad, Larry.
So you stepped in his pee. I pee on the floor sometimes, too.
Do you really?
Accidentally, yeah. I spray.
A little spray action?
And nighttime, I pee a lot, so I don't...
Yeah, me too. I'll look down at my floor, and, like, literally, I always pee on the floor. On planes, I'm the worst.
Well, I mean, the plane is moving around a little
bit. I'll piss on the seat so much that I dab it and wipe it off, and I lift the seat, so if anyone complains, I would just go, what, the seat was up?
That's what I do.
Yeah, that's a good trick.
We all do that.
That's a good trick, yeah.
That's a known trick.
Nothing original there.
Yeah, I didn't know that. I thought I created it. I was trying to patent that idea.
I think we all do that one, yes. Mm. Especially if you know a woman's waiting to use the bathroom next year. Make sure, seats up.
You
like it the whole time.
Yeah.
If there's a woman waiting to use the bathroom when I take a shit, I'll actually drape my log over the seat and leave it there. hope she doesn't see it.
just
sits in it.
Just moving around.
How was the beach, boys?
It was fun.
Larry got burned.
Yes.
Larry got burned. Shit. Oh, boy. Breaking news. Larry got burned at the
Where,
beach.
Larry? Where? Don't leave the audience hanging.
My legs and my chest and my arms.
Whoa. And my arms.
My arms.
My arms.
I got really burned. So did you put any lotion, sunblock on? Oh,
no,
it's
I didn't
careless,
want
Larry.
On
the,
no.
I'm doing TLNM for pizza.
You should have allowed Paul to rub some aloe on that shit.
No, it's all right. I do it myself.
So there was some Astroglide.
he moved out, so I don't have any Astroglide.
Did you guys ever bring women home to Larry's house?
No.
Three bachelors and nothing, huh?
Well, we're here
all the time. We get home late. I get home, then we would all go to the gym. By the time we got back, it was late.
You went to the what?
The gym.
Seriously.
I lost 30 pounds.
You put up 155 yesterday.
I am fine. I don't know. That's fine. I have nothing.
All right. Very nice.
Pretty good.
You would think somebody could have gotten laid during once. Not one time ever. Not one woman ever.
No, we're here working at home. That's it.
That's sad.
Oh, it is.
I know. That's what you guys prison us. Help us.
Oh, yeah. It's our fault. Stop. It's our fault now. It's our fault. It's your fault.
You
it's all your
me?
Fault.
Yeah,
just three well-endowed bachelors.
Pumping iron.
Exactly.
Going to the beach with their gym bodies. Wasn't the beach crowded?
No, it's all fat Russians.
A lot of Russians.
Yeah, all everywhere.
Wait, what beach was it again you said, right?
Brighton Beach. Right? No.
Oh, Brighton Beach.
Island. I'm guessing. That's totally a guess.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, is it Brighton?
It's Brighton Beach, yeah.
How's the water? Do you guys go in the water?
Cold.
No.
You didn't go in?
I go in, but it was too cold.
Right.
I go past the rocks, but it was too cold.
Ooh, you go he's past crazy. The rocks. And Paul's looking at you like, really?
He's afraid. They both go up to, like, their ankles.
Yeah.
Aw.
Why? You're worried
I don't
about,
swim well.
You worried about sharks?
You up to your cankles?
No.
Yeah. I don't swim well.
I'm guessing you're buoyant.
Just drink a coffee.
He's mad at me now.
Yeah. Tell us an Auburn story.
Tell an Auburn story.
All right. In 1997, they were playing the Alabama Crimson Tide.
I got to tell you, Roland can hang in the barrel better than just about anyone.
He's fine. Anyone.
Oh, he'll get beat up, but he'll...
No, he's not fucking... Oh, he hasn't flinched once.
Oh, he'll fucking swing the whole way.
Mars was flinching.
Mars
didn't want to get in on it.
Mars didn't want anything to do with that shit.
Yeah, Mars was just up against the wall.
Right. What's going on with the rocks? Why wouldn't you go past the rocks? What is that, the jetty or something there, Lair?
I go past the rocks.
What is it, the jetty?
I guess. I don't know. I go far out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I not when we went. It was too cold.
It was too cold.
Sounds awful.
I'm enjoying all this, really.
Are you?
Because I don't get a lot. I don't know enough of the dynamic. It's fun to see all the kids at camp fighting amongst themselves.
Yeah, let me see pictures of Brighton Beach. Wow, that looks like not a fun beach.
No, not at all.
Very rocky. Like
yeah, it is.
Those are the rocks he goes past. Rocks. He goes past those.
Oh,
rocks,
that's right. What you're talking about, rocks. That's Eric, a lot of rocks.
Bikini pictures.
No, you're using the wrong rocks, Nagel.
Oh, now he's luring E-Rock into this.
Eric. Utterly
well,
worthless.
Get on the computer. Show him how it's done.
Oh,
shit. Show him how it's done.
Shots.
I don't know the Guido hotspots.
Guido hotspots.
Oh, E-Rock said, I don't know the Guido hotspots.
Are you living in Brooklyn? You should know.
Ooh,
are you saying E-Rock doesn't do a good job on the computer, Larry?
I'm not saying anything.
Well, you kind of said it.
I believe so.
Wow. How come we can't get Samuel Jackson?
He's only doing like four shows. He picked them.
Which
he does four?
Four?
Wait, what else is he doing?
Yeah.
EW.
Dom.
Sway, I think.
Sway's good.
And
Andy.
Andy, that's it.
It's on the Catholic channel. That's a weird one. The Catholic channel's the only one making sense.
I don't know why we can't get him.
He has rep picked him.
We peed right
who's
next
rep?
To him.
Did they have other people with him or no?
She has her own company now. She just started.
Yeah. All right, are we done with these guys?
Yeah. Yes. This is interesting. Yeah.
I liked it.
Anything else? Get it out. Get it out.
Come on.
We're all good, Roland?
I just lunch will be.
I'm buying you lunch. I'm buying lunch. I'll buy lunch today. I already said I'm volunteered for lunch today.
I'll buy you lunch.
You
can't today.
Yeah. Roland, is Paul perfect? Seems like Paul's perfect.
No, I mean, no one's perfect now.
Yeah.
What's Paul's issue there, Lar?
He's a shit starer.
With his cock.
Which is a talent.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. We got to the bottom of it. Thank you, Lair. Literally. You.
Buy me lunch.
Huh? What do you say?
Just buy me lunch.
Kidding.
I'm buying them lunch. You're not invited. Everybody gets to go to lunch.
We'll throw some money into the lunch fund for the boys.
Throw in my friend Roland out of your house.
Yeah. Thank you, Roland.
Buying some good lunch.
Were they happy with the Gary Byrne interview?
Yeah, he was very happy.
Yeah, it was fun.
He was excited to meet you guys. He's been a fan.
Gary Byrne was a fan?
He's been a fan of you guys. I'm like, all right.
Interesting.
Right. You need to hip check me one more time when you go behind me. Just one more time.
Can't help it. This camera was fun watching Paul trip back there before. Yeah. I always like when Paul trips behind the four cameras lined up. It's really a weird.
Got five cameras in the studio now.
Well, you know.
Yep.
Got to make it look good.
Yep. All cannons.
Yep. All right, we should break. We still got the cast of Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll coming in about 15 minutes.
Yep.
With Bobby Kelly. And Dennis Leary, and who else were we getting from the cast?
The really hot one.
The young one?
Bobby Kelly.
Young Bobby Kelly.
Young Bobby Kelly.
With his hair.
All right.
Young Bobby Kelly.
Jimmy's got some things going on. JimNorton.com. He's going to hit the road another week or two.
Yes, for Edmond, Oklahoma, for Minneapolis, and also Fargo. My first time in Fargo. I can't wait. Oh, Liz Gillies. Yeah, she's really beautiful.
Yeah, she's got a lot of followers on
She can sing,
on the social media. Yeah, she does a very good job.
She's got quite a delightful voice.
She's very lovely.
But then also check out the new Swarm the podcast. Second podcast coming out for the UFC tomorrow.
Who do you have on?
Supposed to be John Jones.
Ooh.
So fucking UFC fire.
You're going to have John Jones on?
Tomorrow's
stuff. Rock.
Wow.
Rock was great. Promoted my Mouthful of Shame tour.
Ooh.
Very nice of him.
How did you do that?
He asked me if I was on my tour. He said, the Mouthful of Shame tour. And then he hashtagged it when he tweeted
Oh,
me.
That's awesome. Good for you.
Cool. Wish it helped. How big a flop I am. The Rock can't even help me.
Wow.
That's how you finished in showbiz, when the Rock throws his hands up and goes, I tried,
That's
kid.
All I can do, Jimmy. That's all I can do.
It's not like he has a lot of followers, though.
Nobody. Yeah, nobody follows. Dwayne Johnson. Yeah, nobody's paying attention to anything he's doing.
You're watching you're watching OJ Made in America?
On episode 3, yes.
Did you come across Cheddar Biscuits yet?
No.
OJ's friend that talks.
Oh, yeah. That guy. Yeah, he talks like that.
I
told the juice.
Yes.
I can't wait.
You can't
stab the girl.
He had me at Cheddar Biscuits.
Yeah. That's my name.
Yeah, he sounds like Cheddar Biscuits, one of the guys that Norton does.
Great.
Characters, I should say.
I know. Right. not in his regular rotation.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
OJ's friend from way back.
I'm going to piss. You want to pee?
Yeah, let's
take a break, come back, talk to the boys from Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll, and we'll chit-chat with them.
I think Samuel Jackson's ready for another leak. He's an older man.
Let's go find him.
So I think we're going to go pee next to Samuel Jackson.
I'm going to go find him.
Vic Henley live from Loose Crews on the old iTunes. We'll be back.
I want to see Samuel so I can go like, hey, say what again? I'm Brad. You know, maybe role-play the movie or something. Joke with him like that. It'd be fun. Hey, what are you, hey, don't yell at me. I'm over here doing some Pulp Fiction or whatever I would say. Hey, say what again, Brad, you know? Just good-natured. I would say it would be so much fun.
Lighthearted.
Yeah, I would say, hey, be careful. Don't step on all these snakes in the restroom or whatever I would say. You know?
Yes, we do know, Clark.
Kirk Cinnamon.
No, I know.
Yeah.
Okay. It's just good fun.
I love Kirk.
If I had snakes on a plane, I'd be like, oh, no, I hope they're not flying it. You know?
I do like sitting in this chair just so I can see Travis's reaction to all this.
Kirk's a jackass.
Oh, wow.
Kirk's
not going to appreciate
no,
that.
No, he would not like that. That would be cruel.
He'll find a way to spin it into something nice.
Yeah. We break now, Travis.
Let's make them red. Hit those buttons. We're back with the Opie and Jim Show. We have a special guest.
Not me.
We have special guest Bobby Kelly.
No special guest today.
Yes, we do.
Ah, fucking Edgar.
Fucking A.
I had him over my house for Game of Thrones night, Opie.
I heard.
First of all, he had a new Game of Thrones dance, which was infuriating.
Oh, you didn't tell me about that.
I don't remember it.
Can you do it for us, Bobby?
I need the music. I can only do it with the music because it's so stupid and annoying.
What song you need to do it
it's
to?
It's the Game of Thrones songs.
I don't know the Game of Thrones songs.
It's a great,
songs.
The best theme music.
I don't believe in Game of Thrones.
Are you kidding me?
No, I didn't believe in Lost. I don't believe in Game of Thrones.
Okay, listen, I understand losing Lost with that stupid Australian girl. My baby, Charlie.
Yeah,
my baby. I stopped watching
Claire.
It, too.
That's Claire.
Oh, fuck Claire.
Hey, Claire.
Here it is.
All right, let's see the dance.
It kicks in. You got to wait.
All right. I know it's radio, but maybe we'll put the video out.
He kicks in.
This is Jim Norton's new Game of Thrones dance.
Ready?
Go ahead.
It's very good.
So stupid.
That's what he said.
I know.
And then my wife went, oh, that looks fun.
And she started doing it.
That's all he needed. That's all he needed.
There he is. Now Jimmy remembers the Game of Thrones dance.
The head. It's the worst.
What a good song this is, all right?
I don't like it.
You
don't? No, I don't like it. I don't give a shit about any of this.
No, but you don't like this. You don't like the theme song?
It's all right. I mean, you know.
That's awesome.
That accent shouldn't give a shit.
No, you're right.
Fuck this accent. Yeah. I like it. I like fishing and beer.
Exactly.
Thank you. And we're back.
I like a game of pin the tail on the well. You understand it.
We like to call it.
I like it. Let's get mom kicking off the back of it.
So that doesn't seem that bad that he has a Game of Thrones dance.
It's fun. It's not
it's
fun.
It's good natured.
You're just mad because he lured your wife into it. That's
she
what
loved
it
my
is.
Dance. But last year they used to get up and dance.
Yes.
Like, you know, the spinning classical 16th century.
Sure. I'm good, Vic.
I'm good, Vic.
Him and my wife dancing makes me sick to my stomach.
I can see that.
And my wife does this thing. She has this little dance
Samuel
she does.
Jackson there.
What's that?
Sam Jackson's luring. He's doing everything he can not to get near our studio.
Oh, he looks so much shorter.
Look at Roland trying to fucking get Samuel Jackson on our show.
Roland is working it. Roland is working it. I can see him. Right.
Roland's not napping now.
No, by God, he's awake.
I've had worse. I've had better.
Oh, never mind. Roland's just getting a picture.
Are you kidding me?
No, he's just getting a picture. Right there. That's what he's doing.
I thought he was trying to get him on the show. He's just trying to get a picture.
He was just getting a
picture. He is such an ass.
He was just getting a picture.
He snakes on a plane. He's done more than that.
Oh, all right. Well, maybe we'll get him. I don't know.
Snakes on a plane. Don't scream that out, Chip. He's done more than that. Okay? He's done other movies. Pulp Fiction.
No, he did Snakes on a Plane.
Pulp Fiction? No, not Pulp. It's Pulp Fiction.
Let's see, Chip. I don't know why we can't get him. It's so stupid.
Amos and Andrew is my favorite. Him and Nicolas Cage. Isn't it Amos and Andrew? Do you remember that one?
Oh, my God. What a terrible movie.
Exactly.
What a fucking...
Exactly.
But it was so bad, it was almost good.
That's why I brought it up.
Yeah, that's how I am in bed. I'm so bad, I'm almost tolerable. So that was such a dud, I could almost do it again.
It's almost like a bad smell.
Yeah.
I have to do it again.
What is that?
Anyway, yeah, what was going to say? Game of Thrones, that didn't seem that bad. You're just a party pooper that you're not dancing with Jimmy and your wife.
Epi, it's not the dance, it's the noise.
Epi. Epi, it's not the dance.
Epi. Epi. Epi, I'm in a punk band.
That was Epi, right?
From 1985.
I thought it was Epi.
I thought I heard Epi. I like that.
Yeah, you're a fucking
Epi in the morning.
If you eat some peanut butter, Epi. You're allergic. You use Epi. Listen, dude, he does Edgar. Okay, I'll put up with Chip, because my kid loves Chip.
Yeah.
And Chip started, he goes, come on, Max, follow me, walk this way. And he starts walking up my driveway.
Yeah.
I look and my little kid that I just want the best for is walking like Chip up the driveway going, I almost hit my kid. I almost whacked him right in the back of the head. Hey, knock it off.
Cut the shit right now.
So Norton is playing the role of the uncle, where the uncle's job is to do
don't
all
say
the-
uncle.
Good point.
He's not allowed at the house.
Where, you know, you do all the bad shit with your brother's kids, yeah. And then you leave, and then, you know, then your brother's got to deprogram them.
Well, I tell you.
Do you have to deprogram Max after Jimmy leaves?
No, he loves Chip. He just loves Chip. But I tell you, Jim Norton, as far as an uncle goes, we went out for ice cream, and my kid... He kept asking Jimmy, can I have some? And Jimmy, you know, I was expecting him, no, I don't like kid disease germs.
Right.
And he was the sweetest, nicest guy.
You have to be.
He had ice cream with
Max. You can't say no to a 3-year-old who wants some of your ice cream.
Thank you.
And he goes, hold my hand. And little Jimmy took his hand into Dunkin' Donuts. And it was on Gay Pride Day. And my wife, Jimmy, and me and our adopted son, Max.
Wait,
I guarantee they really thought that we were a fucking pride couple.
Yeah,
that's
just
great.
A couple going out with our son for the first time. Proudly having ice cream.
Well, he said it weird too. He said, "My wife, Jimmy."
Oh, when I when
there,
I was,
there wasn't a pause.
There wasn't a comma.
You heard that
no comma.
My wife, Jimmy.
Yep, I was with you.
Oh yeah, he meant me as his wife. Yeah,
yeah, he's my wife. I'm the alpha. I'm the breadwinner.
We all know that.
Yeah, I have the keys
we
to the
know,
car.
Yes, we totally.
She doesn't have keys.
you think gay couples have that whole dynamic going?
Absolutely. Are you kidding me?
I don't know.
It's called people.
Yeah, it's called top and bottom, baby.
top and bottom.
I'm definitely the top.
And the bottom.
Jim's the bottom. Epi. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm a big boss.
So walking along there holding, so your little son holding hands with the devil.
But then, you know. So we go back to we had a barbecue. We had the steak tips from Boston.
I eat bad. A lot of good steak. Hey. I fucking ate so many steak tips. They were amazing.
You can't get the steak tips here.
Yeah.
You can't get steak tips and ice cream. You can't get steak tips in New York City. You only get them in Boston. I have to ship them in from Boston.
Really?
Oh, no. Well, what are great you talking song. About? You cannot get steak tips in New York City.
What is it? Shipping in from Boston. Oh, boo.
Fucking boo. Good God.
is that the new guy who just sung that? That is a good song.
It is a good song. Shipping up to Boston.
Oh, that song?
Yes.
I'm done with that song.
No, you're not.
I had enough.
I am too.
Really?
Yeah, we get it.
Yeah. Hey, it's St. Patty. I know. I heard you. Got it.
Where do you get them from in Boston? Do you have a particular purveyor?
Dom Steak Tips in Everett. There's only one place to get them. And there's
a guy with a whip.
And what? He whips the cow.
Steer, whatever.
Here it comes.
What else?
Here it comes.
Not going to say it.
No, Bobby, you're a big fucking star. We're doing it differently today. For sex and drugs and rock and roll.
So, yeah, Dom Steak Tips, Everett, Mass.
What, you get them mailed?
We actually had them shipped in.
Shipped?
They're so unbelievable that the lady once a year will drive to her daughter's house in Connecticut. You can place orders now, and then midsummer she drives to Connecticut. You can go and pick them up at her house.
We live.
In case you don't want to wait.
You live. You pretty much live in New York City. I think you can find comparable steak tips.
No, you can't.
Tips.
You can't. You can't.
All right.
You can't. All right. You want to make $1 million, Opie? You want to become millionaires?
Yeah, I do.
Did you just say become?
Oh, that's so cute.
I want to be one. Opie, do you want to pile on your cash like Batman 2 when the Joker was sitting on it and then he lit it on fire?
Yeah, that's what I want.
Exactly. I'm telling you, have steak tips.
Are they marinated?
It's marinated, but it's a certain way they tenderize them. There's a certain machine you cannot get.
I love steak tips every time. I just feel like I don't need to go to
My party last year.
They were amazing.
You've never had those in New York City.
No, they were amazing. I'm with you.
Yeah. So, anyways, we have them. We have a great dinner. We go out for ice cream with Max. It's such a great night. Game of Thrones. Chip is there. But then this is where I draw the line.
What happened?
Dumb Edgar and his stupid infant fingernail touching. Nothing.
Yeah, it's...
I hate it, Opie. I hate it because it's just... I don't even know how to do it. It's so annoying. Yeah. And then his stupid little lizard finger touches you with that little nail that he never... It's not long.
My teeth.
Oh.
Just jagging enough.
I get thirsty every time he opens his fucking mouth. Look at his little pinchy mouth. All through Game of Thrones, stupid Edgar and his dumb fingernail followed, and I just
touching him.
Do you get to talk to Jimmy, or is it just characters the whole time he's there?
No, Jimmy's on his phone.
Jimmy's on his phone.
Jimmy's on his phone. I get Chip. I send Chip just to Jimmy.
Do you get Kirk Cinnamon?
Oh no! Thank God, I fucking woof. Do I? I skip over that on Instagram as soon as I see. I'm like, flip. Oh, I hate Kurt. I hate it.
Spin the wheel.
This is why I hate it. Because you can hear his smile.
Yeah.
This is what you hear. Ready?
That's why I like it.
I hate it. With 5 A's. I hate it.
5 A's. That sounds like a good report card.
See?
I hate him.
Right. When you get him down, he's going to hit you from the blue line.
So good natured.
I can't stand him.
Very good natured.
I hate him.
So you're the star of Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll, Bob Kelly.
Yeah.
I saw the first two episodes. I got to say,
Yeah.
Fucking good, man. Yeah. I liked last season, but I think I like this season even better already.
This season's way better.
There's a lesbian kiss with Liz Gillies.
Liz Gillies, Elaine.
She plays Dennis Leary's daughter, and she's got a lesbian scene in the second episode.
It's pretty hot.
That kiss is pretty terrific.
I was watching that. They sent us the episodes, and I was watching it with Dawn. I had to put a pillow over my lap. Because I didn't get to see any of that, but you can tell when somebody kisses on TV if there's a little something something, and there was a little
nice
when they leaned in for that, and that bottom lip they get stuck.
Like I hate the fake kissing on TV and TV shows and movies, but that one they're like, fuck it, let's do this.
Yeah, they kiss.
You could tell they had a little talk. Oh, fuck it, let's do this.
Yeah,
we're gonna do this, right?
Yeah, we're doing it.
We're doing it.
Yeah, let's
and
do
boy,
it.
Do they do it.
Yeah, they do it.
And the other girl, actress, I don't know her name. She was very sexy, though.
She's actually a big Broadway star.
Oh, she sang her balls off in that one scene leading up to the other thing.
She can sing like a motherfucker.
Holy fuck.
Liz Gillies sings like a crazy. Right. I think she's singing today here.
Nice.
She's at the...
In the fishbowl?
At the fishbowl.
How about she sings in here, Bobby? Well, don't you have a pole on your own show that you're the star of?
Yeah, I have the pole. You want that?
I want that.
Wouldn't be bad.
You want some singing?
A little singing.
Yeah, maybe she'll sing.
I mean,
now he's already backpedaling.
No. Yeah. She has great
Bobby
songs.
Sings.
I know. Bobby sings?
Yeah,
Bobby
sings. Of course I do.
Bobby did Journey for us. Who could you do for us today?
Well, I do Journey. You know, I could do AC/DC.
You could do AC/DC.
Sure, it matches his lifestyle.
Jim? My favorite Bobby song is Titty Mountain Highway.
That's a great song.
Oh, that's a damn good song.
Did we have
heard Titty Mountain Highway?
Yes, yeah. Can you do a little?
You don't have to do it again. We got it. We're good.
Yeah.
We got that recorded.
I mean, Journey's my favorite. You know what I mean?
Which one?
Life is a journey.
Here
he goes.
What, he makes my eyebrow quiver. But just one. Eyebrow.
This starts twitching.
It just starts fucking going, like my hate is so precise that it goes into my eyebrow and quivers my eyebrow. Fucking hate it. I can sing whatever you want, man. What do you want? What do you want, dude?
What's your go-to Journey? Like, don't stop believing.
Don't stop believing is my you say that like everybody can do it. I mean, everybody can.
There's other good Journey songs.
But that's a hard song to get. I'll tell you, my friend.
How about a little Love and Touch and Squeeze?
Oh, that's a good one.
Ooh. That's a good one, but I don't really like that one.
He doesn't know the words.
He's a true artist.
How about Lights?
Lighty!
Dennis, Leary, what's going on, buddy?
What's up, buddy?
What's going on?
How are you, man? Better.
There she is.
Absolutely.
Hey, Liz.
Liz, come on. Yeah. Hello, how are you?
Hey, this is Jimmy.
Bobby, what are you doing? Dude.
I'm going to move over here.
Wow, the whole fucking cast.
Hey, fucker.
This is Jimmy.
How are you?
I'm good.
Holy shit.
We're not very organized.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Are we not supposed to be here?
It's my man. Get out of here.
I love this man.
What's up, buddy?
Hi, guys.
Hi, Liz. How are you?
I'll give Larry my chair.
We're on the air.
It's all right. What's up, man?
Give the girls. The girls get the chairs.
How do you know Vic Henley, Dennis Leary?
I think everyone knows.
From the road, obviously, right?
No, from 85. We've known each other for
the Boston.
Right.
Your first time up, I think it was like 84.
Share the mic with him.
Will Durst.
And we fucking adopted him.
Really?
Yeah,
you never told me that one.
Boston comic.
Very cool.
We loved him.
Here, you got a mic right there, Dennis.
Oh, thanks.
I don't like to brag, but
like a fucking...
Those guys were really good to me.
Well, we got the star of Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll in studio, Bob Kelly, and... and then the rest of the guys.
You also have the co-star, Liz Gillies. And then the other co-star, you have Elaine Hendricks, and also the fabulous John Ailes.
Yes, and of course, Dennis Leary.
Dennis Leary, who really could just stand, which is kind of what I do this season. I kind of stand off to the side and watch everybody else steal the glory.
I saw the first two episodes, and I want to talk about the episodes, but then you give spoilers away. That's what sucks about this.
I think we can talk about the first two without giving away too much.
You think?
All you know... Yeah, you don't really know a ton yet, but there's a bunch of other shit.
I really like this season already. Oh, and cool. I like the first season, don't get me wrong. But
I think this season's better because I know the actors better. The writers worked better for them. They worked better telling me I was wrong and to change dialogue.
Right.
And also, there's just some crazy shit that twists to happen as we go along, so you don't really fucking know what's going to happen till the end.
Well, the second episode with Liz doing the lesbian kiss, I'm like, all right, I'm in. Yeah,
I'm in. No spoilers. No, it's true. It's in a promo. You're good. You're good. It's
okay,
good.
That's good a good that spoiler one? To give away, though.
We used it in a promo already. It's
too hot.
We figured that out.
Making out in a bed.
No, if you
not
want
to mention the ending.
If there are people out there that aren't sure, trust me, you want to tell them there's a lesbian kiss.
There's a lesbian. There's a sexy lesbian kiss in episode two,
and it's very sexy. And Bobby and I and all of us were just talking about how
you were mimicking it.
Me and Jim did it.
That I was saying, when you see, especially lesbian kisses in TV shows and movies, you could tell when they're just, it's fake, or you know what I mean? It's like, you guys said, screw it, let's do this. It was
no
pretty
choice.
Obvious you said, let's do this and make sure there's no doubt that this looks and feels real.
We had our game faces on, and I said, do you have a lot of experience kissing girls? And she said, no, do you? And I said, I don't. And so you rolled action, and we did it, I feel like, more times than we needed.
How'd you never know? Can I ask you a question? Was the first girl you ever kissed Ariana Grande?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, really? They did on camera.
But we did it on camera. It was a funny thing, and then it really did accidentally get posted, but I had kissed her. No, it sounds like it's a total obnoxious young thing. How did that leak out? But then we're like,
you guys should Google that.
Hugging,
Ariana Grande, Liz Gillies kiss.
Yeah, let's do this right now.
It's where I got the idea for the scene.
Did you really?
Yeah, can I make that longer?
True artist that
you
are.
My dream is that next year we get Ariana Grande to play a version of herself, and they have a huge makeout scene.
Oh, good.
Perfect. Now, here it is.
No, you don't need to.
Why?
Let's do it.
I can't believe it. How did this happen?
I don't know.
I thought I was going to be silent.
Hope he asked
the
question, which was,
I'm actually, the video's only an hour long. We got an hour, right?
I'm actually one of those likes, those thumbs up. There it is. There it is. That's the one.
Yes. Let me.
I have several different IDs, and I have like 8 likes.
That was Photoshop, the first one.
That's an image.
Isn't that weird? When we were 14. Who does that?
You're in an image.
I did that.
Only 14-year-old
Photoshop that, yeah. That was a long time ago. I forgot about it.
That's a good smooch. But can we see the video?
Oh,
I
don't know,
we're just looking at a picture
of
it.
All right.
That's the video, isn't it?
Yeah, do the video. Why are we looking at photos?
Does it make you uncomfortable?
What made me uncomfortable was watching episode two with my extended family last night in the theater for the first time. My grandmother, my dad, my younger brother. Do you even think about that? It was crazy.
No, I know. It's not my job to think about that.
I know.
It's your job not to invite them to the fucking premiere.
Kiss about 40 minutes long.
It's a great.
Would you have been creeped out if your grandmother yelled out, that brings back memories?
No, she said, you know what? I should be taking hints. I should be more like this. That would be the worst.
Oh, they just showed it.
It's anticlimactic. It's not.
Oh, my God.
It's not.
Yeah. You missed it. Play it again.
Yeah, let's play it again. Oh, we all missed it because we were laughing at Jimmy's line.
You at home, this is what's happening. There are two women.
Oh, thank you. Yes, please.
Here it
and
is.
They're kissing.
There it is.
Oh, my.
All right, here they
it's
go.
It's very brief.
Warming up.
And...
That was a little too brief.
Yeah, that wasn't. Yeah, that wasn't as good.
There,
there's definitely potential there.
Potential for a whole episode.
But did you guys notice last night in the scene? They're behind me. I put because her grandmother's there, her mother's there, the father's there, the brothers. Everybody's behind me. I put my head over my jacket over my head because when she leans in for the kiss, she grabbed tit.
Yes.
She grabbed the titty.
But I did awkward hand. I never seen that before.
Like, yeah. That was not scripted. She improvised.
Dennis, you got a better kiss out of her. That's a nice kiss, but you got a better one for your show.
By the way, same episode. Just for people, first episode this year is fine, but the second episode with the one we're talking about, it has that lesbian sexy kiss, and it also has Elaine Hendricks in her underwear as a threesome.
It's a threesome.
I'm just trying to sell the show.
Now, the second episode's all about threesomes, and you know.
Yeah, it's all about experimentation and living life to the fullest.
Right.
You want to sell the show? John Corbett gets. We get to see his
everything.
I mean,
the
whole Corbett.
So
the Harvey Keitel.
Keitel's cock was just out in like every fucking
movie.
So she's got a piano. I have no pants on. All right, I'm walking around trying to help her, and then he's a bad lieutenant. All right, so I come over to the car, I pull my pants, and I start jerking off. All right. All right, that's enough. He's the last temptation of Christ. So, all right, Judas comes over to Jesus. He's not wearing anything.
Okay, smoke. I'm at the counter.
Yeah.
My pants are down.
I like how you two fuckers ran with that.
Yeah, I know.
Bobby didn't think we sold the show enough with the lesbian kiss and threesomes and how to go down that road.
John Corbett, let me tell you something. He's half Navajo. He's got some type of Indian blood. Not one hair on his leg.
Yeah,
his leg is beautiful.
he does have
Elaine's leg, who is amazing.
Hair. I can tell you that there's hair.
I can back you up because I was in the trailer when that happened. When we were doing I'm not going to give away too much, but John was doing.
You were in the trailer. I had it rubbing up against me.
Yeah. No, maybe not.
We don't want to give away too much, but. Corbett has no hair in his body except fucking right around his cock. And then he has a lot of fucking hair. It's like Grandpa. All the hair went like, let's hang out with the cock and balls and let everything else do it. Be on its own.
You guys got very good chemistry. It's very obvious. You guys had fun, huh? Filming this thing?
Man. Fucking blast.
It's pretty damn obvious. Yeah, sometimes you get cast in here and you can tell, all right, they're on to their next job and they're done with it. But it looks like you're really having
there
fun.
There is no next job, man.
That's why.
We're with Dennis. I'm moving into Connecticut, Dennis.
He's my new favorite person.
Just pointing at a picture of Hitler.
John Ailes is all right.
Oh, shit. Yeah,
everyone's good. I want to ask you about the music really fast.
Yes.
Obviously, you write all this, right?
No, I don't. I don't write all
I thought
music.
You wrote a lot of it.
In terms of the music or the episodes?
No, the music.
No, this is what we do. And this is the first year, it was myself and Chris Phillips. You probably remember the guy.
I love Chris.
Chris Phillips.
So Chris is the producer in the studio. And what we do is we take the studio for about 3 weeks. We come in with, you know, a bunch of musicians, friends of my guys who were in my band when I used to play live.
The Roth Boys? Are the Roth Boys involved?
Well, Adam passed.
He passed
away last fall.
How the fuck did I not know that?
Yeah, it was...
Oh, goddamn. Anyway, sorry, back to funny.
We go in there. I have ideas.
No, I'll talk about that later.
Liz has ideas. I love Adam. We throw it in the middle of the room. And, you know, she's the dominant voice of the show. So it's really... We have to make sure she's comfortable with what we're doing.
Okay.
So we just kind of go in there for about 3.5 weeks and just bang away at it. And
yeah.
The other weird thing this year is we have this thing that we can mention. This last year, Rehab's character had written a 29-song cycle about the Irish potato family. Yeah. Well, Campbell Scott buys that because he wants to turn it into the next Hamilton.
Right, on Broadway.
Yeah, so we had to write. I didn't have anything to do with this. It was all the other guys and my son, who also writes music. I said, guys, you got to write like 7 songs for a hip hop musical based on the Irish potato family. And they have to be real songs. And a couple of them have to be fucking funny because we have to actually shoot the show.
Sure.
So we mounted the show called Feast, and Campbell plays a version of himself, and he's the star of the show. And we have like 7 fucking numbers. Some of them are dead serious numbers, and some of them are fucking funny.
Well, here's the question, though. Do you write the whole song or just the piece you know you're going to use in the show? Because Elaine has a country song on the first episode.
Wrote the whole song.
But the song sounded great, and you only...
That was Chris's song.
You only hear about 20 seconds of the song, maybe.
No, but you can get it on the soundtrack.
Oh, that's what you do.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure you guys were like, all right, we just need a piece of a song that sounds like a country song.
We do that way, but most of the time...
They're full songs.
Because you don't know what you're going to use.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Bobby, has Bobby sung? I want Bobby to have a song on the show.
Oh, Bobby.
I sang one song.
Let me jump in here about Bobby real quick. He's in the past year and a half,
this
years, has actually learned to play the drums.
Yeah.
And he's really fucking good
now. We're all friends with Bobby, so we went through it with him.
Yes.
I thought he was losing his mind because one day he Instagrammed a drum set. I'm like, oh boy, he's losing it. And then we finally found out it was for this show.
But for his life crisis.
I love it.
Because we're used to him picking up weird hobbies and stuff to get, you know, distractions.
Bobby's fly fishing. He's not dead.
So with the drum kit, that's what we thought at first, and then we realized it was for, you know, sex and drugs and rock and roll.
And John, you know, basically taught himself how to play the bass. These guys we don't have to worry about anymore.
Oh, John, you didn't play before this?
No.
He lied.
I did lie. And Dennis called me.
I said, play the bass?
No, you didn't say that.
Yes,
you said,
did.
Hey, what kind of bass do you play? And like, what are your favorite songs? Like, we got some great styles. Like, what's your favorite style? And I'm like, learning the bass right now?
You did the right thing.
Yeah.
Get the part.
Yeah, Deliri, actually, I thought I had to audition.
Dennis.
Deliri.
Deliri.
I get nervous around him. Listen.
Deliri.
I'm kidding.
Okay. Now I want to make him laugh.
Are you?
I have one mic. Here you go.
All right, back to
you. It's like a fucking podcast. Here you go.
Gene Rayburn.
I was downstairs smoking a butt, and a guy walks up to me just off, you know, he's waiting for an autograph from somebody, not me, maybe you. He walks up and goes, hey, Bobby Kelly, man, he's a genius. And I'm like, I know. It's like, and then I waited, and nothing. And I'm like, that's it. Bobby Kelly's a genius, and I just wanted you to know.
You're still smoking? It's almost impossible to smoke in this world now.
Not really.
No.
Not really.
You can
no.
smoke. He goes.
He figured. No, but he's got
stories.
Different rules, though.
I get stories all the time.
They won't let me smoke on this floor. I have to go downstairs and outside.
Yeah, we had dice sparked up in here one time.
And we got
a lot
of trouble.
It goes through the vents.
Oh, Jesus.
So we got in trouble.
Really no
we'll do a scene, yeah, and we'll start with like
around.
3 butts in the ashtray, and then by the time we're done, there's like 70 butts in the ashtray.
I'm not the only one who fucking smokes, by the way, on this show.
Hold on. Dennis, is there a short version of the Bloomberg story?
Oh, I smoked in the mayor's office.
There you go.
Come on. They were doing this fucking thing. I'm just going to make it short because I can't remember everything because I have Alzheimer's. They were doing a thing for the fire department. They invited me. Rescue Me was still on the air. Bloomberg's in. And, you know, Bloomberg, he divided the mayor's, you know, working floor up into cubicles. Remember all that shit he was doing, like making it, yeah. like we're all on the same, you know, yeah. wavelength. But they still had the official rooms where you would have meetings and have your pictures taken, right? So I'd never been in this room, but the firemen were a little down on Bloomberg at the time because he wouldn't give him a fucking pay raise. So we're in this room, and we got to wait like 10 minutes for him, and they go, it's going to be 20 minutes. So look, and it's a really fancy room with old rugs, big fucking paintings and everything, old fucking chairs. So I look over, and I see like a really old-fashioned, like, you know, the standing ashtray?
Sure, with the handle.
Art Deco ashtray, yeah. And I'm like, dude, I'm going to fucking light up. And they were like, no. And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do it. So I light up. There's nobody in there except me and these firemen. And as soon as I light up, it's way across the room.
Everything's
the door
safe.
Opens, and in comes the press guys for the mayor and the mayor. And I'm like, this is fucking awesome. So I smoked in his office.
Nice. Did anybody comment or no?
Oh, yeah, he was rip shit. Oh. You know, you can't smoke in here. I'm like, well, you shouldn't have a fucking standing ashtray.
Yeah, why do you have the ashtray?
Tell him what it was. Firefighter's a fucking race.
But tell him right? what the ashtray was. It was an antique.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, not supposed to use it.
No, there's no such thing as an antique ashtray.
Thank you.
All right, right. I'll switch back
it's
to
like
your
an
side.
Antique coaster. Yep. What the fuck is that?
Spittoon.
Yeah.
What else do we get to see on the show this year? Just to get a little promotion out.
It's hard to say stuff without giving shit away.
Well, Bobby and I.
Huh?
Yeah. There's a lot of, Bobby and I make out the whole time.
This year it's a lot more serialized too. Like one episode goes into the other episode. I mean,
yeah, I
noticed
once
that. You get into it, you get into
I noticed
it.
That.
And it's definitely worth hanging in for the sexy girls. Also the episode where we go with the opening night of that show Feast. Their characters are both working on.
Yeah.
As percussion designer and supposed composer.
Supposed.
We go, it's like Birdman. We go to for the entire episode, we go to the opening night and we mounted the show. We had choreographer, you know, 30 dancers. We built a set
right.
and we go to see Feast, the Familton,
right.
what we're calling it. And we spend the entire episode there. And it's Campbell Scott's fucking hilarious as this yeah. guy, man.
Who's Campbell Scott?
Campbell.
Great actor. You know him. He was in Singles. He's in everything.
Father yeah. was George C. Great. Scott.
Yeah, he's been around forever.
Oh, in his soup. No, I don't know who he is.
I don't know. When you see his face,
yeah, you see his face, you totally recognize
that guy, of course.
Yeah, this guy, right?
Of course.
There you go, Campbell Scott.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Nice.
Yeah, when you see his face.
Is that a real, oh, yeah?
Yeah, no, I've seen him. I just don't know
yeah,
where.
Yeah, we know
okay.
who he is.
His face very familiar.
Yeah,
okay.
I couldn't pick a
friend. He's a damn good actor.
Blow that up.
He is. He's really good in this show.
Secret Lies of Dentist.
That's him.
He was the crew.
Look at him.
Never
big,
saw that.
Big
Hamlet.
What's the Mammoth film?
Noises off on Broadway.
The Mammoth film? No, I can't think of the Mammoth film.
Yeah. Oliana.
House of Games.
Thanks.
No. House of Games. Joe Montaigne.
Yeah,
Joe Montaigne. Right?
That's a great fucking movie.
Awesome. Oh, and J.T. Spider-Man. Walsh was in that.
Yeah. J.T. Walsh, who used to fuck Michelle Pfeiffer.
Did he really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that.
He died young. He died at 54, massive heart attack. But before that, he seduced Michelle Pfeiffer and was her, you know, she was his live-in girlfriend for like 5 years. And the whole world was going like, how the fuck?
Yeah.
And they couldn't figure it out.
He's one of those guys that everyone knew, but then nobody knew his name. Like, yeah, that guy.
That guy's a great fucking actor.
Amazing character actor.
But I also give him props because...
Fuck Michelle Pfeiffer.
He should have gotten the fucking Oscar.
I know.
Just for that.
Absolutely.
Lifetime achievement for living with Michelle Pfeiffer for 7 years.
Yeah. Wow.
Goes to J.T. Walsh.
He stole it from Frank Lopez.
Then she went to Fisher Stevens.
She did.
She went to Fisher. She went two nerd weirdos in a row. She went from J.T. Walsh to Fisher Stevens, I believe, or something like that.
Yeah, she did. And David Kelly.
Lovely.
Yeah. Good choice.
Mm-hmm. He was gay, but he was banging her back in the 80s, J.T. Walsh? Or like,
yeah.
He's great in Blood Simple. He's in the first Coen Brothers film, Blood Simple. He's amazing in that. Yeah, he's really
I love the girls. You guys are talking about banging Michelle Pfeiffer. And the two girls are like, yeah, we're out.
We're done. Michelle Pfeiffer's like top 100. Yeah. She's would, like right? top three girl crushes of all time.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's perfect.
Yeah.
What's
I'm
your
very, very on board.
I'm going to hear the other two.
By the way, who are the other two?
1990s Angelina Jolie.
And Madeline Albright.
It's really weird.
Madeline Albright.
Jessica Lange.
Oh, yeah, Jessica Lange.
Jessica Lange. That's a pull.
Kate Blanchett. Two. I have like four. Yeah.
Titanic?
She's adding to the list as we go.
That's Kate Winslet.
I think I smell a plot for season three.
Kate Winslet's doing sex and drugs and rock and roll. Yes, playing a huge part.
I sometimes get told I look like Michelle Pfeiffer.
I said that.
Yes,
I can see that. I can see it. Yeah, absolutely.
We can all see it now.
I've never seen her live in person, and it's going to be hard for me to believe she has more mesmerizing eyes than Elaine does. Because look at those eyes.
The eyes are ridiculous.
Sometimes when Elaine's talking to me, like when we're on set, she'll talk and she'll have some really good idea going on.
Yeah.
In the first sentence, I just go, ha, ha, ha. And at the end, I go, and I tell her, right? I say, like, yeah. I'm sorry.
You got to say it again.
She did that to me when we were playing one of the songs, and that was the first time out in front this season. She steps out in front, and she was doing the song, and I'm drumming, and then she turned to me and kind of came at me in the moment and was singing.
And
it
you
to
skipped
me.
The beat.
I just stopped playing. I was just like,
is this happening right now?
And I was like, oh, shit, I'm playing.
Well, you're sitting there going, holy shit, I think she likes me.
Because I usually have Dennis in front of me or Liz, and but she stepped in front of me. I got used to them and what they do.
Yeah.
I didn't know she was going to fucking do that.
Yeah.
And she just swung her hips and it was a V-neck down to her belly butt and her eyes, and then she just pointed at me, and I just was like, hey. Hey, and then she turned around and fucking left like most girls do. But yeah, she's so hot.
Come on, man.
You know, they leave because I pay them.
And then I met you in your dressing room.
Whoa, don't what? Don't talk. Come on, man.
Hey, what's going on there?
Look at that. Hey, you can see season one on Hulu.
Yes,
you
can
watch that.
Thank you,
Wayne. Yeah,
you have one day to binge watch it. It's today.
But you certainly don't have to see the first season for the second season.
No,
you don't.
Okay.
It helps to kind
yeah,
of
it helps because you really
no because I'm trying to help you guys out for
yeah.
real because a lot of people go I'm not going to invest in this show
sure.
because I didn't see the first season. I'm just saying
no, they can pick it up.
Yeah, go watch the first season. Residual checks are nice.
No, I'd rather them do that for
some
you.
Some of us need them.
I'm with, hey,
Bobby's always thinking ahead.
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm with Bobby on the cast.
Bobby's always thinking ahead.
Go watch that. Look at that. Look, there you go.
Roll up, yummy.
Bobby, that's supposed to be bacon.
It looks like a roll up.
It's just so weird. It's Tim Robbins.
It looks like
Elaine and you.
Yeah.
Bobby, you still going to sing for us?
I know, that's weird, right? Why the fuck?
You want me to sing?
What, you were going to sing before?
Yeah, what do you want me to sing?
Sex and drugs and rock and roll.
Sing Crimson and Clover like you sang at the rap party last year.
Tim Robbins.
Liz just pulled out.
Crimson and Clover is a good genre.
Tim Robbins
did a great job last year.
That's Jacob's Ladder, isn't it?
That's Jacob's Ladder, yeah. That's him in a tub. That's either him in the Jacob's Ladder or looking at his Sandra. Fuck it.
I think it was going to be a good one, too.
It was going to be a hot one.
Here's
but I stumbled. I had a flat tire at the end.
I was going to say, did you sit down in that dress last night?
Good God.
Yeah, it's out.
Jesus Christ.
Wow.
I had to leave.
Wow, way.
I know.
No kidding.
What's that? Is that the dress last night?
Yeah, that was the dress last
night. Yeah, look at that.
That's a little short for my taste.
Like a don't wear it then. Jesus.
Yeah, because you can tell she's a woman. See you guys later. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. Thursday nights at
that. That's good.
Holy
wow.
Downtown.
That's downtown. Steph Curry right there.
That was a damn good one.
Well, they are saying we got to wrap up. You guys, you guys you guys doing press all day.
Sex and drugs and rock and roll Thursdays at
10.
Thank you.
10 p.m.
On FX. FX, right?
Starting tomorrow night at 10. Yeah, on FX.
Tomorrow night, hit the button, watch it live or record it and watch the whole season and go to Hulu and watch the
first season.
And if you don't know what it's about a band that almost made it, and they have a second chance through this beautiful girl, Gigi.
Who's Dennis Leary's daughter on the show.
Yeah. And
actually, it's more about a bass player who resurges his career in the musical theater world.
It's actually about a drummer trying to find a father figure and a family, a surrogate family, through food.
Yeah, thank God you got to the food.
And masturbation, yeah.
Sandwiches and jerking off. The Bobby Kelly story.
He did. Last year he had me jerk off a guy for barbecue.
It's that, so true.
Like, it's that far from the truth. Really? You know? Well, that could never happen.
Barbecue is really good. So.
I thought he was just a great actor.
This was a great method.
That's what's funny about that scene last year. The guy, they actually gave him a prop cock for me to hold.
Stop it.
What?
Yeah.
I swear to God.
I didn't know that.
And then Dennis's agent from William Morris.
She was visiting, right?
Yeah, she's, yeah.
And she's watching the first take and she goes to Serpico, listen, let me go in there and give him a couple of fucking hints because I've done this a few times.
Little Jewish chick. It's like, listen, this is how you do it.
He's totally
she
not
goes,
doing
it. Grab
right.
You want.
Yeah.
Oh, you were pretending you didn't understand. We got a triple from Norton. All right, man.
Nice.
Thursday nights, FX.
Thursday.
It's
10 a.m. FX.
It really is a very good show.
Yes, it is.
Thank you.
And you can tell by this interview, the chemistry is right there. These guys really work well together. So,
thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll on FX tomorrow night at 10 p.m. is the season 2 premiere. Nice meeting a bunch of you guys here.
Come back and see you.
See you later.
Good to see you, brother. Why don't we take a break so we get a picture?
Yes. Okay,
hit the button. Nice. Hit the button. We're done, I guess. Thank you. All right. JimNorton.com for his dates. And Vic, just come back tomorrow.
I'll come back tomorrow.
You might as well finish out. We'll see you guys tomorrow.